I heard payback's a motherfucking nigga. That's why I'm sick of getting treated like a goddamn stepchild. Fuck a punk cause I ain't him. You gotta deal with the 9MM. The day's coming that you all hate. Just think if niggas decide to retaliate and try to keep me from running up. I never tell you to get down, it's all about coming up. So what they do, go and ban the AK. My shit wasn't registered any fucking way. So you better duck away, run and hide out. When I'm running real slow and the lights out, cause I'm about to fuck up the program. Shooting out the window of a drop top pro ham. Well, I'm shooting, let's see who drop. The police, the media, suckers that went pop. And motherfuckers that say they too black. Put them overseas, they be begging to come back. They say people more gangs and drugs. You wanna sweep a nigga like me up under the rug.
I know, so I understand you believe in the Bible, believe in God and all that stuff. And we as young brothers have been coming together with these Bible studies. And we've been coming to a certain knowledge of who we are according to the Bible. And, you know, I was raised as a Christian. We was all raised in Christian churches. And we felt like we came across information that was not shared with us through the church, and we felt like it was important that our people know this information. So, and what we're doing is we're seeking, you know, I guess
clarity.
Yeah, through elders that have been in the studies and preach for a while, because you know neither of us are preachers or anything like this. But we want to seek an elder because we have these certain questions, and we want to just go into depth into this knowledge with an elder that's more experienced. So this is why we're reaching out to you to come sit with us in this type of atmosphere.
First, my question is... excuse me, brother. Let me cut you off.
Uh-huh.
We need to... can you just tell us a little bit about, you know what I'm saying, your beliefs and how it differs from anything that we might see on TV or any other... Can you just talk to us a little bit about that?
Well... it goes back basically Judeo-Christian. I mean, from the time of Moses being handed the Ten Commandments and 613 other laws, straight all the way down to the prophesying of the Messiah coming, Yeshua. And of course, when he came about, establishing the New Testament in his blood. And of course, I came to faith in Jesus Christ in 1982. On the basis of faith.
No, I mean, are you like, what's your denomination?
If you used to ask me my denomination, I would say I was a follower of Jesus. I don't even claim a denomination, because I know when you stand before the Lord Jesus in the day of when He's rewarding the saints, Paul addresses that question in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, where he talks about the church is not divided. So with me, I would be more one who would follow Jesus of the original handing down of the New Testament when he established the church that day.
Well, the reason I ask that is because you know, you got different denominations. You got the Holiness, you got Pentecostal, you got Baptist.
Yeah.
And you know, I was raised up as Pentecostal, where you know folks spoke in tongues and so-called caught the Holy Ghost.
Uh-huh.
And this is the kind of atmosphere that I was raised in. And was that in any of your environment?
Yes, it was. Yes, it was. Actually, I grew up in the Baptist church, but I have been baptized in the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. I received the gift of the Holy Spirit back in 1987 through the laying on of hands, and it's filled with the power of the Holy Spirit.
Oh, okay. So you believe in speaking in tongues?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Actually, I practice that on a daily basis, praying in the Spirit. That's what we call it, praying in the Spirit.
Okay. You have your own church?
Now, again, the church, I attend the People's Church, but of course I acknowledge that the body of Christ is one body,
right,
worldwide.
Right, right.
And that's how I see it.
Well, you worship on Sunday?
Sunday, and follow Jesus every day. It's not, to me, it's not just a particular day for me. It's a daily walk.
So do you you celebrate Christmas and Easter?
Many of the traditions of the church, many of the churches that we attend, you know, they all accept that. And
okay,
that's been controversial because a lot of people do believe that that's linked to Catholicism, and you know, many of them.
Well, you had said something about historical facts of Judaism and how Christ, the land that he was, you know, brought up in. Did they partake in these particular practices?
Many of the Jewish believers up to the time of Christ, it was just strictly worship of Christ on the Sabbath at one time. But it's four scriptures in the Acts of the Apostles that's talked about how the church was meeting on the Lord's Day, which is called the day after, which is the first day of the week, which is Sunday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's great, because see, that's what we want to dive into. We want to dive into these particular facts. We want to put them on the table, and then we're going to go into the Bible and see what the Bible actually says about these things. Okay?
Yeah.
If that's okay with you?
Absolutely.
All right. Now, can you show me where they was practicing Christmas? Can you show me where they was practicing Christmas in the Bible?
Christmas is more of a tradition. That's not going to be found in Scripture, because that's something that is just adapted traditionally over the years in the church. But in actuality, the Christian, like as far as Christmas is concerned, that's not, you're not going to be able to find that in Scripture. You're only going to be able to find the point of origin when Jesus was born, and the incarnation, when he was given into the world. And of course, traditionally, that's why many people hold that day as a day to be worshipped, basically.
So, but it said the reason we worship is because this is supposed to be Jesus' birthday.
Right.
Okay.
And that's why I was told.
Jesus was born outside in a manger.
Yes.
Okay. Do you think that's possible in the dead of winter?
If you know the Jewish holidays, it was during the time when it was warm outside, which is during the time of around April to March, right in that time frame.
Well, do you realize that Christmas was being celebrated before the birth of Jesus?
I've heard that mentioned before.
Yeah. All right, can we go to Jeremiah 10, 10 and 1?
I'm there.
Okay.
Go ahead, brother.
Hear ye the words which the Lord speaketh unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen.
The Bible says, telling the followers and believers in Christ, learn not the way of the heathen. So obviously, the heathen have a certain way of doing things.
Right.
Right? Go ahead.
And be not dismayed at the signs of heaven.
Be not dismayed at the signs of heaven. Now, I'm just going to get ready to outline some of the customs that we shouldn't do.
Which I'm familiar with the scripture that you were talking about, but yes, go ahead.
Okay, go ahead.
For the heathen are dismayed at them,
mm-hmm.
for the customs of the people are vain.
The custom of the people are vain. Go ahead.
For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of a workman with the axe.
Mm-hmm.
They deck it with silver and with gold.
Deck it with silver and gold.
Mm-hmm. They fasten it with nails and with hammer, that it move not.
That it moves not. Go ahead.
They are upright.
They are upright.
As the palm trees.
Mm-hmm.
But speak not. They must needs be born, because they cannot go. Be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, neither also is it in them to do good.
So the Bible is outlining a custom of the heathens that the believers in Jesus Christ are not to partake in. Does that sound like Christmas to you?
Okay, now actually, let me explain to you what that scripture is talking about.
Oh, okay.
Now, if you read, of course you're reading Jeremiah, but you want to read the whole scripture in context, it's actually talking about idolatry, which is correct,
mm-hmm.
Because in verse 8 it says, but they are altogether stupid and foolish in their discipline of delusions. Their idol is wood. Now, see, of course, the Lord in the Ten Commandments, he mentions about not worshiping idols.
Wood or stone.
Right, right, mm-hmm. because that's putting the idol before him, easily being greedy, that can be considered idolatry. Love of money is idolatry.
All right.
It's a lot, but see, now, of course, now this scripture is also referring to the Jewish believers at that time, because the Gentile believers didn't come to them much later. But this is what this scripture is talking about, because at this point in time, the Lord was married to Israel. This is the time when he's addressing the Jewish people through the prophet Jeremiah.
So Israel are just Jewish people?
I didn't catch what you said.
No, are you saying so Israel are just the Jewish people in general?
No, the Jewish people, the Israelites, this is what it's addressed to, because at that time that's who the Lord was dealing with, the nation of Israel.
So
it was before Christianity.
Where's the nation of Israel today?
Back in the land that was prophesied for them to come back.
So those white people with the I have my phone. I had pictures of them guys.
Yeah, like Jerry Springer.
Like Seinfeld.
Seinfeld.
those are the Jews.
Yes, but see, you'll notice, the Lord speaks in Scripture about he says, now he addresses the question about Jewish by birth. Now, there's a Jewish by birth, but there's also a spiritual.
Okay, we're not talking about the spirit. Right now, we're just dealing with the physical seed
of Abraham.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Then yes, that's in regard to the people of in Israel to this day.
Okay, you realize that it said that I'm not trying to sway from this Christmas thing. Okay, so before I ask you that, I just want to make this straight. So this is not talking about a Christmas tree.
Well, it's talking about an idol, which is what is it's talking about it being decorated. But
okay, what it says a tree. They go into the forest and they chop the tree down.
Right.
And then they bring the tree home and then they deck it with silver and gold.
Correct.
What? That's not Christmas?
Yeah, that's Christmas. No, mm-hmm. No question about
it. Without a shadow of doubt.
Yeah. Yes, on the aspect of the tree. But again, you know, Christmas traditionally now.
Now you're saying traditionally, you have to understand the Bible just said for the customs,
right,
which is the same as tradition.
Right.
See, the customs that these people follow are vain.
Yes.
Okay, so if they're vain, and it's talking about a Christmas tree, okay, and it said that they bring it into their house, The Bible says you're not to bring any abomination. You're not supposed to bring these into your house. So how do you all of a sudden in 2012, or however long it's been since, can now do this?
Correct. I won't dispute that. Mm-hmm. That's correct. Yeah.
So if the customs are vain, we probably should not worship Christ. We probably shouldn't take that day into account.
Correct. But again, like I said, it's a celebration of their celebration.
Whose celebration?
The heathens.
The Catholics. Or
the heathens.
They're the ones who have brought that about.
Okay.
Right. And then, of course, the church today has adapted that. But
how can you adapt it when this is forbidding you to do that?
Correct. I won't disagree with you because, again, there's a lot of things that are done in the churches today that doesn't measure up to truth.
Well, I mean, you had stated that you practice this, though.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
If you're practicing this and the Bible says we shouldn't, first of all, you need to get the history on Christmas. You see what I'm saying? Because,
yeah.
See, Christmas, December 25th, is Ham had a grandson.
Right.
Okay, from Noah, you had Ham, Shem, and Japheth, the three sons of Noah. Okay, one of the sons was named Ham. Ham had a grandson. He had a son named Cush, and Cush had a son named Nimrod.
Yeah, and then, of course, yeah, Nimrod. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Nimrod, okay, his birthday is December 25th, okay? And because they celebrate this because his wife, after he died, Esau killed him. Okay, so after he died, a tree erected in front of his grave. Okay, and they was told to everyone to bring presents and put them up under this tree. And if you didn't bring a present, your head would roll. That's why you got the balls on the Christmas tree. So and back in the ancient times, those were actually people's heads hanging on the tree.
Right.
Okay. So the Bible said these customs are vain. This custom came from Nimrod. Okay, so if true believers, the Bible, if this is our book, and the Bible is warning us against these customs, should we not listen?
Yeah, absolutely. Agreed.
Okay. And so, back to the Jews, let me get Revelations 2 and 9. Because, see, you stated that the Jews that's in the land of Israel today are the Israelites, but you have to understand that the Bible does not say that. Let's see. You there, brother?
Okay. I know thy works and tribulation.
Hold on. I want him to see it.
Oh, okay.
2 and 9, and then give me 3 and 9 after that.
All right.
Revelations 2 and 9. Mm-hmm. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I knew the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews are and are not, mm-hmm. but are the synagogue of Satan.
Okay. So, you know, it's only one people on the whole planet.
No, thank you.
It's only one people on the whole planet that calls themselves Jews. Right? The Bible says that those that say they are Jews are not Jews, but the synagogue of Satan. Give me 3 and 9. He says it twice, sir.
3 and 9.
Go ahead.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan.
Uh-huh.
Which say they are Jews.
Which say they are Jews.
And are not.
And are not.
But do lie.
But what?
Do lie.
Go ahead.
Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet.
I will make those that say they are Jews come to worship at the feet of the real Jews. Okay?
Mm-hmm. And to know that I have loved thee.
Now let me get Deuteronomy 28 and 68. Because the Bible says precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. That's how you read the Bible, right?
Right. Deuteronomy 28, 68.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
Now this Bible never contradicts itself.
Right.
It never goes against itself and says one thing in one spot and says something different. It's a continual one thing, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships,
uh-huh.
by the way whereof I spake unto thee.
Now this was the children of Israel after they, the first 15 verses was the blessings, and the 15 to 68 was curses.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it says, if you do not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe and do all his commandments, these curses will come upon you.
Right.
And we understand in Deuteronomy 31, 32 that it says that they didn't. They actually failed at that, right? You stated that, right?
History proves.
Okay, read that.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Okay, good. Read that.
Thou shalt see it. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with uh-huh. ships.
With ships.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee.
Go ahead.
They shall see it no more again.
They shall see it no more again. Mm-hmm. What is that talking about? Their homeland.
They'll never see it again. Oh.
The Bible is not going to lie. The Bible states that they failed. And it said they will not see their homeland again. So if those that's in Jerusalem right now today are the real Jews, that makes the Bible a liar.
Well, actually, when you read the scripture here, this is pretty crystal clear. If you go to Hebrews chapter 9 and 10,
Hebrews what?
9 and 10.
Go ahead.
Actually, we can go to, let's see. Okay, let's start at chapter 10 and verse, let's look at two different scriptures here, but okay. Chapter 10, verse 14. It says, for by one offering, he perfected for all time those who are sanctified, meaning set apart as holy. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws upon their heart, and on their mind will I write them.
Uh-huh.
Then he says, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more.
Mm-hmm.
And then it says, now where there is forgiveness of these things, there is no longer any offering for sin. Now if you go back in the same chapter, chapter 8, starting at verse 7, he says here, he says, let's start in verse 6 actually. He says here, he says, but now he has obtained a more excellent ministry, but as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant, which he has enacted on better promises. He says, for if the first covenant had been faultless, then there had been no occasion for it. For a second.
Mm-hmm.
For all any fault with them, he says, now notice he's addressing them. Now he's talking about a particular people. Now he says, addressing them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will effect a new covenant,
right,
which mm-hmm. was established in Jesus Christ,
huh?
With the house of Israel.
With who?
Mm-hmm. The house of Israel.
Huh? With the house of Israel.
And with the house of Judah.
And right. with the house of Judah.
Uh-huh. And it says, not like the covenant which I made with their fathers, who's his address.
Wait a minute. Is it any more other nations mentioned after Judah?
Judah. Because you know what?
I'm just asking, is it any other nation after Israel and Judah?
Not at all.
No. Okay. Okay.
I'm going to tell you why.
Okay.
I'm going to tell you why. If back there was an incident that happened in the Old Covenant with Benjamin, who his concubine, one of his servants, was raped, which he pushed her out the door, and then she was chopping 12 pieces, and he sent them out to the 12 tribes of Israel. When he did that, the Lord enacted a judgment against Benjamin, and those two kingdoms were divided. You had Israel, and then you had, of course, Judah. At that point, that's when they were divided. That's why but he's never forgotten either one of them, because he's addressing both people here.
Oh, he never forgot them. But that's not why the kingdom was split. Now, the kingdom was split because of Solomon and King David. It was professed that Solomon, he said, for the sake of David, I'm not going to rip the kingdom from you, Solomon, but I'm going to rip it from your son. And for the sake of David, I'm not going to take all the nations. I'm going to leave one nation for you to rule. And the 10 tribes went on their own and chose a man from Ephraim to be their king.
Right, which they did.
Jeroboam and Rehoboam.
Right. But you'll notice now, you mentioned King David.
Right.
Which is the lineage of what King the Lord Jesus came to.
Oh.
But you'll notice that when you mention him, the promise that the person that he chose was Abraham, who was one of King David's descendants. So the Lord promised to Abraham that I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars of heaven. And he also said that he was going to bring them to their own land. And in Ezekiel chapter 36, 37, and 38, he speaks of that. He talks about, I'm going to gather you from all the nations that you're scattered, which that prophecy was fulfilled in AD 70 under Titus when...
70 A.D. Right.
Yeah, 70 A.D. Mm-hmm. when they were scattered across the world.
Right.
And they were brought back May 14th, 1948, back to the land of Israel.
Wait a minute, brother. The Bible says that they will never see their homeland again.
They didn't. The originals. That's what I'm talking about. He was addressing the original people at that time. Matter of fact, if I can continue on.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, it says here. It says, we were, I think...
Verse 9, verse not 9. According to...
Okay, now it says, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers, which he's addressing their fathers. Mm-hmm. It says, on the day when I took them by the hand and to lead them out of the land of Egypt. So he's addressing these particular people at that time. And it says, and they did not continue in my covenant, which they didn't. And it says, and I did not care for them, says the Lord. So see, the Lord was against them. You know, I mean, that was clear. And he says, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel, or the house of Israel. It says, after those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws into their mind, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
So have he changed people yet?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. And it says, and they shall, and that's his promise. And he says, and they shall not teach anyone his fellow citizen, and everyone his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all will know me, from the least to the greatest of them, and I would be merciful to their iniquities and their remember their sins no more.
Mm-hmm.
So that, and see, that's what I'm saying. See, now clearly that house, that particular people, were extremely rebellious against the Lord. Even when Moses threw the Ten Commandments down and broke them,
mm-hmm.
They were extremely rebellious. So he naturally, of course, you know, because not everyone in Israel was obeying the Lord. Even in the New Testament, you got those who obey the Lord, which the blessings come upon, and the ones who do not obey him. And the ones who do not obey him, of course, they're going to be rejected. Only the ones who obey. Jesus says, you know, when you love me, by obeying my commandments.
Mm. Right, for
so,
sure, right.
So, I mean, and that's automatic. I mean,
that's a key scripture.
That's a key
brother.
Scripture. Yes. Yes. That is a key scripture.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Plus, one thing, like now mentioning the Jewish descendants, like even Jesus himself. Jesus was the king of the Jews. He's Jewish.
So when you pray to Jesus,
mm-hmm.
what do you see when you pray to him?
I see the Father. And I can see that explained.
Okay, but I'm asking you, what image do you see? Do you see a white man when you pray to Jesus?
When I pray to Jesus...
Is that not what they have given us? Everywhere you've ever been, mm-hmm. Jesus has always been white.
Right.
He has never changed. It's always been white my whole life.
Right.
Has it been like that for you?
I won't deny it.
Okay, so when you pray, mm-hmm. is that what you see?
What I see is I pray in faith. I don't see an image like that. I see Jesus is described in scripture.
How's he described his scripture?
Eyes like flames of fire.
Right.
Sword coming out of his mouth.
You think a physical sword is coming out of his mouth?
No. It's a metaphor. It's an image. Yes.
Is that the description? Image.
Yes.
Okay, but is that the description that they've been giving us?
No.
How do you feel? That don't make you feel something?
Well, not really. I'm going to tell you why. Because, I'm from Memphis, Tennessee. And so from that area, you get a lot of, there's no question. When I was growing up, I got a lot of racial hatred from there. But any person, any person who has that amount of hatred is going to alter truth. It's just like Satan. Satan is the one who infiltrates that satanically organized system that's behind that. Is what infiltrates that type of hatred. That's one of the reasons why Jesus, when he came, he taught to love your enemies. Now see, that's not possible unless you're born again. There has to be a transformation, a new birth. That's something that only, we go back to when we talk about the spiritual Israel. The only way that's possible is it has to be a new birth, a transformation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's on the basis of faith. That has nothing to do with...
All right, well, let me get Luke.
Uh-huh.
Let me get John. John chapter 4:24.
God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Wait a minute. And in truth.
Right.
So if let me see that, says Ray Bourgeois.
Oh, okay.
Do you have the Apocrypha, sir?
Yes, I'm familiar with it. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you know who this is?
Hey, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
Yeah. Okay, this is the image that had been given to us for Jesus Christ, okay? This is the image that it came from. This is the actual man that was painted. His name is Cesare Borgia. He was of the Borgia family. I don't know if you ever seen that show on Showtime called The Borgias.
It's not right now.
Okay, and they call them people the original crime family. Okay? This man was the son of Pope Alexander Rodrigo Borgia, whose name was changed to Pope Alexander. Okay, this was his son. Okay? These people commissioned
morning to you, man.
Leonardo da Vinci, okay, and some of the other painters to paint the image of Christ. Okay? So what I'm saying to you is, what do you see when you pray? And so if you say that you worship in spirit, well, the Bible says you must worship in spirit and in truth. So if this is not the truth, then I can't be okay with this.
I agree with you. Now I'm gonna tell you like you mentioned that was brought about by hatred.
What was?
That picture?
Those images.
But you have to understand, it's continually going on. Let me tell you, 90% of the people that we deal with have no idea that Christ was a black man.
Well, okay, let me show you a scripture in John chapter 14, which I'm sure you all are familiar with, but like you mentioned truth. And
John 14?
John chapter 14, because you mentioned truth. And... he reveals himself basically clearly in the scripture where he's talking about that. But he says in John chapter 14, verse 5, he says, and he's addressing Thomas, one of his followers, he says, and Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now see, when he says that, of course, Jesus is the embodiment of truth. He is the truth.
Right.
That's who he is, because they call Jesus in John chapter 1 the Word. And, he's always been. He's always existed.
Mm-hmm.
So when he's revealing himself here in truth, that's who he is. The spoken word which that's how he describes himself as well in John chapter 1 and 1:14. It says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Now, when you go over to 1 John, it talks about in 1 John chapter 1, verse 1 through 3, John is writing, like the Apostle John, he's writing a specific thing that wasn't possible, but only for the witnesses of Jesus who were living at that time. And it says, in verse 1, it says, what we have heard from the beginning, and what we have heard, and what we have seen with our eyes,
right,
and what we have looked at and touched with our hands, right, concerning the word of life.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that the life was manifested, and we have seen and testified and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and is manifest to us. Now, yes, they seen Jesus, and they're describing him there. But you know, of course, if you go to John chapter 8 or John chapter 20, we see something that Jesus himself said that's very significant.
St. John.
St. John.
Chapter 8.
And he said something very profound to Thomas again.
Go ahead.
That same disciple. Uh-huh. But he says in chapter 20, verse 26, and it says, after the 8 days, his disciples were again inside.
Oh, chapter and verse?
20, verse 26.
Sorry about that. Go ahead.
Oh, no problem. And he says, and after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them, because the first time he wasn't. But he says, Jesus came, and the doors having been shut, stood in their midst and said, peace be with you. And he said to Thomas, reach here with your finger and see my hands.
Come to bring up one of the biggest adventure. Must be dementia that you ever thought you could touch our credentials. What's the initial? You'll be John Rock delivered.
And he says, Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Now, and Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, you have believed. But he says, blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. So see, Jesus, even in the New Testament, when the Apostle Paul is addressing not only the church, but when they send witnesses out to proclaim the message, he's telling them that I want you to go out, but you're preaching the message of the word of faith. You're preaching them because the word is going forth spoken. It's going forth just like he spoke in the beginning. And let there be light. Let there be, you know, he spoke all those things into existence. That's why they call Jesus the Word. The Word is what changed me, because I didn't see an image of Jesus, but I believed on the Word that was spoken.
Your point is very good, and I'm not disagreeing with anything of your point. But I'm trying. You're missing what we're trying to say. Let me get Daniel's 10:6. Uh-huh. Let me get Hebrews 7:14. Let me see Hebrews. Let me get Hebrews 7:14. See, because you have to understand, sir.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says you must worship in spirit and truth. Okay? The reason that you believe that those Jews that's in Jerusalem today are the real Jews is because of this image, sir. This image is what allowed them to be able to go into a land that wasn't theirs. Okay? The President Ahmadinejad said at the Conference of the United Nations, he said, how could the Jews leave black and come back white? And the only reason that you're believing that those people are there and you accept that in your mind is because of this image, sir. Now let me prove to you the image that we have is the true image. Go ahead.
Daniel 6, verse 1.
10:6.
Oh, 10:6.
Daniel's 10:6. See, you can't say, oh, well, you know, it doesn't matter, or it ain't that big a deal, or, you know, that's something wicked they did. No, it's really deeper than that. You're exactly right when you say it's something wicked they did, but it has now has have you believing in 2012 that those that's in Jerusalem are Jews because of this. Read that.
10:6. His body also was like the burrow, and his face as the appearance of lightning.
Right.
And his eyes as lamps of fire.
Go ahead.
And his arms and his feet like in color to polished brass.
like in color, to polish brass. But we know in Revelation that it said brass that had been burnt in a furnace. So if you took a penny and you put it in an oven and you burn it, what happens to it?
Which I've done before. I've taken welding and
it gets darker.
Right.
Come on, sir. Let think about that for a second. Okay, if it get darker, now you read what you got and you give me Jeremiah 14:2.
And I got Hebrews 7:14.
Yeah, get that first. Hebrews 7:14. Okay, because you have to understand, 14, sir, 10, 10, 10. Jesus Christ was a Hebrew Israelite of the tribe of Judah.
Right.
That's what he was, right?
Right.
So if he was a Hebrew Israelite of the tribe of Judah, if he had a body, he had a color.
Right.
Okay. And let's not forget, when Jesus was born and Herod tried to kill him, where did he flee to, sir?
Egypt.
Okay, so if he flee to where the black people are, it's most likely that he would be black too. If he was white like this, he would have went up in Europe somewhere.
Right, right. Okay, and that's a valid point. But let me mention something to you. Let's say that's true. I mean, no question about it, because I know that's true. But let's say that your point is, because it's well taken. But you know, when you look at Jesus for instance, John chapter 1, and of course, all through Hebrews in the New Testament, you notice that Jesus is called the Lamb of God.
Mm-hmm.
Whether Jesus was white, black, or any other of those colors that is mentioning, which I know I see you stressing out on it because of, this.
We didn't make an image.
Right.
They made an image.
Right.
It wouldn't be no problem. We can serve him whether he's green or blue.
Right.
We would serve him.
Right.
But they made a picture.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. And that's true. But you'll notice, it's just like if you're in a court of law, if you go before a judge and you're guilty of something, like that judge, like let's say you murder somebody,
mm-hmm.
or rape somebody or something like that, just as an example, you know, most people today, like they try to look at God like, okay, I'm gonna say I'm sorry, and that's basically it,
mm-hmm.
and they're gonna be led into heaven because they say I'm sorry. But if you go to a judge and you say, okay, I'm sorry, judge, I murdered somebody, and you got all that evidence against you, or I raped somebody, that judge is not going to just say, oh, because you said I'm sorry, I'm going to let you go. A fine or a punishment is going to have to be done because of that crime that was broken. Well, you got 613 laws in the Old Testament, from Genesis all the way up to Deuteronomy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Ordinances and different things that the Lord laid out. Every person, like the scripture says, is concluded all guilty under sin. So Jesus, in spite of his color, was the Lamb of God. So a fine had to be paid, which in that courtroom in Jerusalem, basically, Jesus, all our sins was placed on him, and he was punished for what we did, and he took our place.
Okay, but that's right, not here or there. Right. I agree with that.
Correct.
But let me yes. elaborate on what you said about the court of law.
Yeah.
Let's think about this for a second, okay? Before that man committed that crime, and before he appeared in court, he had to have a warrant, sir. And right. Listen.
Right.
He had to, in order for them to go get him, mm-hmm. he had to have a description, mm-hmm. sir. They, if the man is black and they bring a white man in the courtroom, what is the judge going to say?
Right. Mm-hmm. But again, just like,
come on,
like,
sir.
Like I was saying regarding Paul, it says in Romans chapter 3, it says, concluded all under sin. Everybody is guilty. And the only way that fine was paid is through Christ, because he spoke that word in Greek, actually. It says telio. When it, like we translate it, it is finished, but in actuality, it is paid in full.
Do you realize we're descendants of slaves, sir?
Right, yes.
Okay. Do you know your history beyond the slave ship, sir?
Yes, I'm familiar with it, yes. All the way back to the Garden of Eden.
You are?
Yes.
So those that came in on slave ships to America, which is who we are descendants of, what was their nationality? What was their lineage? What language did they speak? What food they ate? What land did they come from?
I see where you're coming from. I know what you're going on that. But what's the greater situation?
So what you're doing is you're trying to convince me that it doesn't matter. No, and I'm telling you that it's of amount importance.
No,
of knowing who you are.
Right. Let me get these scriptures.
Okay.
Because I'm gonna let you say your piece because we're gonna let the Bible speak. Right. Because the Bible has the answer.
Yes.
There's no need for us to speculate or go back and forth when the Bible has the answer for it. You can't say it doesn't matter when the Bible tells us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read what you got, brother.
7:14.
Uh-huh.
Hebrews. For it is evident that
hold on. Let him get there.
Okay.
I need him see it.
Okay.
Jeremiah Hebrews 14:2.
Okay, 7:14.
Mm-hmm. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's evident that our Lord and Savior sprung out of the tribe of Judah.
Right.
Now let's get the identity of the tribe of Judah. Okay. Let's see what they look like, okay?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Jeremiah 14:2. Right. Judah mourning.
Hold on. 14:2?
14.
Yes. Yeah. And you give me Solomon, because you said Jesus Christ is a descendant of King David. So if he's a descendant of King David, he got to be a descendant of King Solomon.
Correct.
Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me get Solomon's 1 and then and read 1 and then I'll drop down to verse 5 after that, okay? Mm-hmm. Hold on. Let him get this. You there, Jeremiah 14:2?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Judah mourning.
Judah mourning. So it says Judah is in mourning. Judah's not happy. Those people that's over there in the Jewish land own about 95% of the banks all over the world. Did you know that?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so the Bible says we wouldn't be having success. It tells you in Deuteronomy 28 that these curses are going to fall on you. You will be cursed in the store, cursed thy basket in the store, cursed in the field. Okay, so we wouldn't have no success. Those people have actually fought wars and defended themselves. Okay, but the so-called black man in America has not, and they don't have their land, they don't have an identity, they don't have nothing.
Right.
Now read that.
Judah mourneth, and the gates thereof languish.
Go ahead.
They are black unto the ground.
They are what?
They are black unto the ground.
Not black like unto this cord here, sir, but black as to the dust of the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then give me what you got. Here's King Solomon. Solomon 1:1.
The song.
Hold on, let him get there. Because I want him to see it because, listen, the Bible is outlining what those Israelites look like.
Right.
Without a shadow of a doubt.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes.
Chapter 1:1.
Oh, okay. Oh, Songs.
Songs of Solomon,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I got you right. Okay.
1:1?
Yeah.
The Song of Songs.
Mm-hmm.
Which is Solomon.
Which is who?
Solomon.
So we understand that we're talking about King Solomon, okay?
Yeah.
Drop down to verse 5.
I am black.
I am what?
Black.
Go ahead.
But comely.
But comely. Who? What people on the planet calls themselves black and beautiful, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I am black, but comely.
Comely means beautiful. Okay? Go ahead.
O ye daughters of Jerusalem.
O ye daughters of Jerusalem. Go ahead.
And the tents of Kedar.
Go ahead.
And the curtains of Solomon.
Okay. Now listen to this for a second, okay? Because no matter how much a white person stays in the sun, they will never get dark, okay? Go ahead.
Look not upon me because I am black.
Look not upon me, sir, because I am black. Go ahead.
Because the sun hath looked upon me.
Because the sun hath looked upon me. Now if this happens to this guy here, he'd be in trouble.
Right.
Okay,
he
go ahead.
A curse from the sun.
Right.
My mother's children were angry with me.
My mother's children was angry with me. And what did they do? What'd they do? Go ahead.
They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyards have I not kept.
Let me tell you something, sir. This man cannot be a keeper of a vineyard. And he cannot be a keeper of sheep. Okay, why? Because these things require you to be in the sun for an extended amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
Okay, these people could not fit this. Now let me get
If you notice that scripture, that, like the one that you're addressing,
mm-hmm.
If you read it carefully,
Job 30:30.
Okay, if you read it carefully now, because you like when you read these, you know, I always try to read them in context. But this scripture, like the one that you said in verse 5, it says, "I'm black but lovely, or comely, O daughters of Jerusalem."
Is that a King James Bible, sir?
This is the New American Standard. But I've
sir, you're going off, because I'm gonna tell you why. Because everything that we're gonna bring forth tonight is going to be from the King James, and it states black.
Right.
That book does not do that, sir.
The New American Standard actually is the only one that does outside of the King James. So yeah, it says that too.
Okay.
But see, this is my point. Like this is what I was gonna say. If you read this scripture in context, you'll notice that when the person who's actually saying I am black and lovely, it's the Shulamite woman.
No, sir. Read that from the top again, sir.
The Song of Songs.
The Songs of Songs, which is Solomon. Now he was talking to the daughters of Jerusalem.
Right. Correct. But you'll notice in verse 2, it says, may he kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. And then and you can go down the whole scripture, it says, your oils have a pleasant fragrance, your name is like purified oil, therefore the maidens love you. Draw me after you and let us run together. The king, which is Solomon, has brought me into his chamber. We will rejoice with you and be glad. We will extol your love more than wine, rightly do they love you. I am black but comely, O daughters of Jerusalem.
No. Why would she say I'm black and comely and then start talking to the daughters of Jerusalem if she's talking to Solomon?
It says, like, if you notice, it says, O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar, which are black goat skin, no doubt about it. And it says, like the curtains of Solomon. See, and then it says, do not stare at me because I am black. The sun, and then it goes down and it addresses like the scriptures that you just read.
Okay, that's fine, sir. But now we finna get about 5 more scriptures. Okay, okay? And we'll see if you. Okay. I'm being for real. We're gonna get 5 more scriptures to see. Give me Job 30 and 30, and you give me Jeremiah 8.
Okay.
Job 30 and 30, 8:21.
Job 30 and 30.
You there, sir? 30 and 30?
Yes, I am.
Okay, go ahead.
My skin is black upon me.
My skin is what?
My skin is black.
Now, see, listen, sir, you can't run around on that.
No.
There ain't nothing you can say that make you run around on that. This man stated that his skin was black. Could this man ever state that, sir? Ever?
No.
Right?
Right.
There's something going on, sir.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
My skin is black upon me, and my bones are burned with heat.
Now give me Jeremiah 8 and 8. Jeremiah 8 and 21. 8 and 21, sir. Okay. Give me Lamentations 1 and 5.
8:21. Jeremiah 8, verse 21.
Yeah. Hold on, let me get there, bitch. Mm-hmm.
You said one and five.
Hold on. Where page is that, yeah?
891.
Yeah, let me get Lamentations.
We had Jeremiah 8:21.
Yeah, let me get your Lamentations 5 and 7.
You want Lamentations 4 and 8?
Lamentations 4 and 8? That too?
Yeah, that's what you want.
Yeah, I want 4 and 8, and I want 5 and 7 and 8, and I want 10.
Yeah,
yeah, okay. You there?
Yeah.
All right, good.
Let's go to Jeremiah.
Jeremiah 8 and 8, sir.
8:21.
Okay.
For the hurt of the daughter of my people, I am hurt.
Of my people. Go ahead.
I am black.
I am what?
Black.
Go ahead.
Astonishment have taken hold on me.
Okay, now give me Lamentations. Lamentations. This next verse, sir, is a killer. Okay? 4 and 8. Let me get Lamentations 4 and 8.
You
learn
the
fish?
Yeah, I'm
good. All right.
Go ahead, read that, the fish.
Their visage is blacker than a coal.
Now, if you look up this word visage, okay, that means vessel. Okay, it means your core. It means
basically your appearance, your
right, outward, right. Yeah. My vessel is what?
It's blacker than a coal.
Go ahead.
They are not known in the streets. Their skin cleaveth to their bones, and it is weathered.
So we understand this is talking about skin, sir. Here's another scripture. Now drop down to verse 5 and 7. I don't need 7. I need 10. Yeah.
Okay.
5 and 10.
5 and 10.
Go ahead.
Our skin was black.
Our what?
Our skin was black.
This is unbelievable, sir. Read it again.
Our skin was black.
Go ahead.
Like an oven because of the terrible famine.
Now, have you seen the internment camps in Jerusalem? I mean, not in Jerusalem, but in Germany. When they did that to the so-called Jews, did any of those people turn black, sir? Any of them? I'm just saying, though. When you seen them, they was bloated, they was hungry, they was starving, right?
Yeah.
But did any of them turn black?
I don't think they had enough time to do so, but if they did, no. No, I didn't see it on any of the images.
That's right. That's right. Now, we have to understand that that's a problem. And now, we finna read to you because, see, we have the Apocrypha. Pull out your Apocrypha, Bereshit. And I'll let you see mine. You got one, sir?
No, I'll let you see mine. Okay.
Let me get...
You're familiar with the Apocrypha.
Yes.
Yeah, he said...
Yeah, it comes from the Septuagint. Frowned
1611.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
King James.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Let me ask you something, sir. Uh-huh. If you go to any other standard of Bible...
Mm-hmm.
All these scriptures that we're bringing out to you, sir, is removed. Why is that?
Yeah.
And they saying different things, you know, other things to try to dissuade what the original said. That should be a red flag, sir.
Yeah, no question about it. I mean, because in the original Hebrew, all those words do appear.
Okay, so I can appreciate that you love Jesus no matter what color he is. Okay, but we must identify who he is so we can identify who his people is, because the Bible said those that say they are Jews are not Jews. So if we are to be sending money to Jerusalem to help the Jews, shouldn't we be looking for the correct Jews to help?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, no question about it.
But here's another key question. We read Deuteronomy 28 and 68 that said that they would go into captivity on a ship and be sold unto their enemies. Did this happen to those so-called Jewish people, sir?
To some of the descendants, yes.
No, they
were divided into 12 tribes. That.
So you understand it was 12 tribes. Mm-hmm. Where's the rest of the tribes at, sir? If those are the Jews, then they're the Israelites, where are the 11 other 11 tribes?
Well, I know back, I guess in... probably about the year 2000, probably earlier than that, I know many of the ones from Ethiopia migrated back.
Listen, sir, that doesn't even make sense. How can an Ethiopian be an Israelite? Just think about that for a second. It's like me saying I'm a white man, sir. Or I'm a Chinese man. Right. I'm black and I'm Chinese. That's impossible, okay? Because Ethiopians was the son of Cush. Cush Empire is the Ethiopian. It's the same thing. Mm-hmm. How can Cush... which is the son of Ham. Ham had a brother named Shem. Shem is where the Israelites come out of. How can I say Ham's children and Shem's children is the same now?
Well, traditionally, they go by the Shulamite woman in the Song of Solomon. And they claim that because she came from the south, the queen of the south, and they believe that they had children, and of course, she went back to that land. But that, like I said, that's only tradition.
Listen, sir, now you're going into Haile Selassie, okay? See, now you're going into Haile Selassie, who said in 1957 that he was Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So why would I take that doctrine, sir? That don't even make sense.
Well, see, the thing is, though, you have a lot of weight based on their practices of Judaism then, which...
Listen, sir, someone being converted into Judaism does not make them a Jew. Right. If I all of a sudden become a Buddhist, does that make me a Chinese man, sir?
No, but
you can say, oh, it's a Buddhist down the street, okay? But that does not, when they come up, they're looking for a Asian-looking man. They're not looking for me, okay? So when they come, they say, well, dude, you're not Asian. I mean, you might practice, Buddhism, but you're not Asian.
No, okay, no, but now if that's the case, which is well taken, but how would you where would you go with that scripture in Revelations where it talks about people from all tribes, nations, and tongues worshiping?
Where do you go when Paul says to the Jew first, right, then the Gentile?
Right, which is
wait, he's making a distinction.
Right.
Okay, so it's no way that I can come after Paul says this and say that the people are the same when he made a distinction, difference.
Right, they are different. Right. There's no question about it. There's no question.
You can't clump them all together and say you're a spiritual Israelite. That's impossible, sir, to be a spiritual Israelite.
Yes.
The only thing you can do is follow a follower of the God of Israel.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Because Israel is God's portion. That has never changed.
Yes, but you'll notice in John chapter 10, when Jesus is talking about the brotherhood, mm-hmm, those who have believed on Christ, he talks about sheep of another fold, and he's going to make those two into one.
Now, okay, just because everybody's believing the same thing, does that all of a sudden make those believers Israelites?
Right. There is this distinction. There's no question about it.
Okay, so you have to accept that distinction, sir.
But see, the thing is, now, let's say all that knowledge of all the genealogies and the differences of the different people, but there's only one way to be saved. And if a person, let's say they believe all the
give me Hosea the information 4 and 6.
And yet never places their faith on Jesus Christ to save them, it would have been in vain. And that's what I'm saying.
Listen, sir, how can I place my faith in this guy? I mean, for real, think about this, sir. How can I place my faith in this guy? I'm going off. I'm looking at this guy, and I think that white people that's in Jerusalem are Israelites. When I have paintings of the Egyptian walls right here, when Israelites was in captivity, mm-hmm, as black people, sir.
Right. But you'll notice something too, also like mentioning that regarding salvation. If, for instance, Ephesians chapter 2.
You there 4 and 6?
Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 and 9, for instance. It says, by grace you've been saved through faith, and then not of yourselves.
It's okay, but you got to believe in spirit and in truth, sir. Right. If you remove truth, the truth part, and just worship in faith, you're missing it.
But also you'll notice when, like you mentioned truth, in John chapter 17, Jesus says that. He says, your word is truth. And he goes back to the word.
This word, sir.
Right.
Oh, so now we're bringing forth that truth. The truth is that the Israelites are black people. And guess what, sir? You're an Israelite.
Right.
Of the tribe and the seed of Judah that Jesus Christ himself came out of, sir. Now, wouldn't that be a great and wonderful thing if that was true, sir?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, but so why would you deny that when we read to you and we're showing you pictures of listen, we didn't make this up.
Right.
These are pictures of the actual tomb in Egypt.
Yes.
Are those people black, sir? It is black and white. Are those people black, sir? Come to where they get one of the biggest adventure. Must be dementia that you ever thought you could touch our credentials. What's the addition? Okay, so if they're black, and I've come to find out that this guy right here come from this guy, and this guy was incest. He had sex with his sister. He killed his brother. He killed his brother-in-law in order to continue to have sex with her. He was a liar and a thief and a robber. And we don't say that. The Apocrypha says it. Read your scripture, and then we're going to get this Apocrypha, sir. So I just want to, so you can just get an understanding. Read that.
Isaiah 4:6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Read. Why?
Because thou hast rejected knowledge.
Now, if you say, listen, all that's great, and all that history is okay, it's good to have that history, but, you know, it really doesn't affect my salvation. You're missing it. Because now you have rejected the knowledge that the Heavenly Father has sent to you. Now you're saying, you know, all that's good and everything, but I'm just going to focus on, you know, what I want to focus on. No. Okay, now hold on. Okay. Give me Romans 10. Romans 10, I'm gonna let you get that in. Let me get 10. Romans 10. And this is our problem right here.
Right.
You have to understand, sir, this is our problem. Go ahead.
Brethren,
is you there? Go ahead.
Brethren, my heart desires in prayer to God for Israel.
Listen, sir, it says for Israel, yeah, sir. Okay, Israel must get back into their position because Israel's duty is to teach the other nations. That's what their duty is.
Right.
If they're not holding their part in, how can the other nations learn, sir?
Right.
How can someone that's not an Israelite teach me about this book? How can I go to a congregation in a church with a white man and he's teaching me about the Bible? That's totally backwards. You supposed to stand up and say, sir, I'm an Israelite, and I'm going to tell you what my forefathers, what we did. Uh-huh. But another nation shouldn't do that. But when another nation do, this is what happened. Read.
Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel.
For Israel, go ahead.
Is that they might be saved.
Right.
For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God.
Sir, I appreciate your love for Jesus. I really do. Read.
But not according to knowledge.
But not according to knowledge. Sir, this is not according to knowledge. Okay. You have to have the knowledge part in order to combine it with the faith. You cannot have faith without knowledge.
You're absolutely right. Now, okay, let me address this.
Go ahead.
Okay. Now, you'll notice, and I'm sure you agree because you read it in context. I mean, clearly that's what it's talking about. Now, 9, 10, and 11, that's talking about Paul addressing Israel. No question about it. Now he's addressing his brothers right there. Mm-hmm. Now, the Jewish people, and Paul himself being Jewish. But you'll notice he is addressing Jewish people there. Clear as day. Now, if you go over to Acts, if you go over to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, for instance.
Sir, how's he addressing... Listen, this is the book of Romans, sir. Right. I mean, you know, this is not the book of Hebrews. Okay. He's addressing the Romans, which were Gentiles and Jew mixed together.
Okay, let me go back to that chapter real quick. I'll show you because you know just from studying when the Greek was written in Koine, that's the language that was spoken of that day. They didn't have the chapter division. They didn't have the verses. They all just read simultaneously. Paul starts writing in chapter 9, addressing Israel, the Jewish people at that time, and he's very specific because he says, now we start at verse 1 and 2, and he says, I am telling the truth in Christ, I am not lying, and my conscience testifies with me in the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Now this is Paul saying this. Now it says, and that I have great sorrow and unceasing grief in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed, separated from Christ for the sake of my brothers.
Wait. His brothers.
And then he uses the term kinsmen. Now, he's very specific when he says kinsmen because he's talking about his actual lineage, his Jewish lineage. He says...
Wait, sir. There's no such thing. First of all, let's make something clear here. There's no such thing as Jewish, okay? Because, listen, if you put the ISH on the end of anything, it means to pertain to. Okay, you know this is reddish, you know, and you about 6 feet-ish, you know. So this is things that mean pertain to the Jews. Listen, they never called themselves Jewish. They never wished to be Jews. Okay, sir, they are Jews.
They are Jews.
And they call if they call themselves anything, it will be Judeans or Israelites.
Right.
And Jew is the came from the word Judah.
Yes.
Judah is the only one of the tribe that is a Jew. There's 11 other nationalities within those tribes of Israel. That's why he's always saying Israel, because Israel.
You must be born through the seed of Judah in order to be a Jew. Now, for their own name gives them away. To say that you are Jewish lets me know that you're not a real Jew. You're something like a Jew because you keep the laws, statutes, and commandments. You're something like a Jew, but you're not a Jew.
You're Jewish.
Right.
Okay. Right. Okay. Go ahead. Because verse 4 is a killer, sir. Verse 4 is a killer. Go ahead.
Yeah, it says, who are Israelites, to whom belong the adoptions as sons, and the glory and the glory of the covenant.
We need this backs up what I just said a few minutes ago about going to a church and letting another nation teach you, and you're an Israelite. Watch this. Read on.
Okay. Now it says, in the giving of the law.
In the giving of the law.
In the temple service.
Wait a minute. In the temple service, sir. So is that not what I just said, sir?
Right.
Is that not what I just said?
Yes, but it
okay. Okay.
It says, who are the fathers in verse 5?
Who are the fathers?
And from whom is the Christ according to the flesh?
According to the flesh, sir.
Right.
According to the Cesare Borgia, sir?
Yeah.
According to the flesh, which we read in Hebrews, he was from the tribe of Judah. We read in Jeremiah that Judah is black.
Right. And of course, in verse 6, he says, and now he's addressing things specifically, like I was mentioning earlier about how just because somebody comes through there physically doesn't necessarily mean they're of Israel.
Okay, that's not we're not dealing with that. Okay. We're not dealing with that, sir, because listen, Jews crucified Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So let's make that straight. Do you think those people are followers of Christ?
By no means.
Okay, so that's what that's talking about, sir. Yeah. We're not dealing with that. Because I'm in complete agreement. If you don't follow this book, I don't care if you are an Israelite.
Yes.
If you don't follow what this book says, then you're against Christ. The Bible says, Matthew 12 and 30, if you're not with me, then you're against me.
Yes.
Okay? Absolutely. So, you know, that's not an argument. Okay? But I need you to really deal with this color issue, sir.
I do. I mean, no question about it.
I need you to really do it, because what you need to understand is that you are a Hebrew Israelite. You are, and I'm going to prove it to you through this book right here, man. This, let me get this information to you, sir, because this is vital. Okay, I mean, this is unbelievable to find out that we've been known as to be a nigger and low life, dirty person all our life, to come to find out we're the actual kings of the earth. You see this right here? Those are the 12 tribes, and then it tells you where they are today, sir. You know where that information comes from?
All 12 of the tribes of Israel, they combine to make Israel.
Let's say that's like the sands of the sea,
all those people.
Correct. Now let's say that that's true, but it still resorts to one in situation. Is Jesus my Savior and Lord? Is that the one that I have to believe on to be saved?
Sir, we already in a complete agreement.
For that payment.
That don't have nothing to do with his nationality, is what I'm trying to get you to understand.
But see,
what's your nationality, sir?
Right.
No. What's your nationality, sir? Can you tell me that?
I'm black. No question about it.
Wait. I asked you what... Think about this for a second. I asked you what your nationality is, and you told me a color.
Right.
Think about that, sir.
Yes.
That don't make sense. Well, what's your next answer?
Y'all tell him colors when y'all have him read all the scriptures and says, I am black.
Well, we were saying black is our nationality.
But the color is giving a description. We're giving a description.
Right. That I am black.
They gave a description of the Israelites.
Yeah. They were describing the color.
But color does not denote nationality, history, or land.
No, of course.
It's black people in Africa.
No, we know what color you are.
Right.
No, we said the Israelites are black.
Right, but you said it's black people in Africa.
Sir, read that to her in the red right there. Can you read that to her? Please read that to her in the red.
Okay. Listen.
I want you to hear what he's going to read real quick.
It wasn't stating that black was a race. It was saying I'm the color.
Oh, that's the color. The Israelites are black.
No, we're asking him
what is his nationality?
What's
not his
color? But you know what?
If I read this to her real quick, sir.
Okay.
Read that to her.
It says a history of ancient black races.
Wait, history of ancient black races.
Right.
All black people are not the same race, man.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay.
Including the black Hebrews. Thank you.
No.
That's what we were saying.
Okay.
Now he said that he's black.
No,
listen,
right,
now.
Right.
You have to understand, we're descendants of slaves. Okay.
Right.
So we as a people, we're known ourselves as two things: black and African American.
I honestly never heard my husband disagree with y'all stating the black.
By no means.
Right.
By no means.
Right.
No. I'm not saying that.
Every time you try to read your scriptures, you talk over him. You did it like 100 times. He's trying to show you about salvation.
But the point is, we want to get
it's more than salvation. We must know who we are. The Bible says lack of knowledge.
Okay. Through the division of the tribe, and that's true.
That's important, sir.
I know they're important because I know Jesus comes from the nation of Judah. So how important is it for you to know who you are? And that's true.
Yeah, well, what's your nationality?
That's very important.
But it's very important. So that's what we're determining.
Okay, that's what we're trying to...
According to the Bible, it doesn't say I'm a black man.
Correct, but...
You know what I'm saying? It doesn't say I'm an African American.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't.
So that's what we asked you. Because if you would have said I'm a Hebrew Israelite from the tribe of Judah, that's your nationality.
If you don't know that, sir, that causes a problem.
Okay, let me read y'all one thing, and I want y'all to just like read this with me.
Where are you at?
Ephesians,
give me the content
2.
For the faith, man. Give me the content for the faith, and
Ephesians chapter 2, and start at verse 11.
Hold on, let me get that.
And if you don't mind, can you read that for me?
I sure will. 18:25, what you read Ephesians were?
Ephesians chapter 2.
Okay.
Starting at verse 11. And I want you to start at 11 and read through 18.
I got it.
Okay, thank you.
Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, we are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh, made by hands.
Wait.
He's reading from the King James.
So it'd be a little bit different.
Yeah, it'd be a little different because you're reading from a
New Living.
You don't even understand why people don't read from those other translations. You have to understand
I understand why.
Mm-hmm. You do. Yeah. So then why are you using that book? That don't even make sense.
It's in today's English. And it's easier for me to understand. But listen, thus and thou and thee.
But you're missing.
I'm not missing because I study this.
Okay,
all these translations are current for you to understand better.
We go behind all the words.
They're flipping from the King James because people don't speak like that today. All they're doing is making it in today's English.
Listen, ma'am, I understand. It's perfectly fine.
I do see what you're trying to do. So please finish reading.
Mm-hmm. That at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promises, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. He hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us.
Okay, read that part again. Broken down what?
He hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us.
Okay, when it says between us, who is he talking about? Between us.
Between us, the Israelites and God.
The Israelites.
He's talking about the circumcision and the uncircumcision.
He's talking about the people that are circumcised.
Two different groups altogether.
Okay.
All the people.
Okay, I just want you to understand. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead.
Format 15, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man.
Okay, read that again. One new man. That's what Jesus did. He broke down the walls between uncircumcised and circumcised and made one new man. It's not no division no more. It's one new person in
Okay,
Christ.
But that's not the point. The point is the Gentiles know who they are.
Right.
They know where they come from.
Right.
They know their history, their land.
But
we don't.
Why Jesus came.
But we don't know it, though.
And why he did it.
Now, remember, you said, you know, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge as it's written in Scripture. And that's true. But you'll notice, like, this is something that the Apostle Paul wrote under the moving of the Holy Spirit, that he, like, God breathed words. But that was another purpose for Christ coming. You see, as they were saying here, everyone who places their faith in Jesus, on Jesus Christ, through the payment that was made at the cross and the resurrection, through that new birth, because Jesus talked about the being born into the, like, through Nicodemus, a natural birth, but then he's talking about the spiritual birth. You've been reborn because in that new birth brings you into, like, you're born into the family of God. He's taking the two sheep and making them one.
Listen, we're not disputing that.
Right.
We are in complete agreement with the two nations. The Gentiles and the Jews. We're not excluding anyone.
No.
We agree.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
But the only problem that y'all not hearing from us
is that the nationality. No, we agree with y'all.
So you understand that you're Israel. You are a tribe of Israel.
I understand that I'm a black person.
From the tribe of Israel.
I descended from Africa.
See, what I'm saying.
I do understand that.
So you have family that speak African, that live in Africa, Ethiopia.
Her dad is from Nigeria.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So she's actually from Africa. So your descendants are from Ham.
Yeah, but can we finish reading this?
Okay.
It's
okay.
Just three more verses.
Okay.
I'm at I'm gonna go back at 15.
The wall being abolished.
Okay. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself a twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were not. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints.
Now that's a powerful statement, because it mentions citizenship. Now see, it doesn't just say flesh only.
But it told you that who the ordinance and the rituals of the church. Who does that?
No question about it.
That's all we're saying.
Right.
We agree with that.
Yes.
We agree.
But for instance, like it says citizenship. Now, basically, what Paul is saying here, that our new citizenship is
in Christ.
That's our real citizenship is in Christ Jesus, who sit at the right hand of the Father. That's our new place. Because this earthly realm is temporary, but our heavenly realm is eternal. Christ reigns, sat at the right hand of the Father. That's where we're reigning to.
Where's heaven going to be at?
Oh, this right here.
Where's heaven going to be?
Well, you know, it's not in this realm. You know what's so crazy?
They have a show out on TV right now. But on Showtime, exposing this information,
right?
And I think I've seen that.
Can we read that man? Yeah. Can we read that in the Apocrypha, man?
It's not right.
It is not
listen,
right.
Listen, it's get us to hatred. Listen. Read along with us on this.
It stem from white, like some white people who have been filled with hatred. But we don't.
Pull it up, man. Solomon 14:15. We just need to get this information, man.
And I want y'all to know, we completely understand about racism.
Okay, so we're not in disagreement with the new covenant. We're not in disagreement in any of that. But what I'm saying is you as an Israelite have a certain role that you need to place. We just read it. Your role and your ordinance is to be a priest.
Right.
Okay, so how can another nation teach you of Israel when you don't know who you are? The Bible says, Jeremiah 17:4 says, my people will be discontinued from their heritage. Who did that happen to?
The African American man,
because he don't know where he's from.
That's true.
We need to discover who we are. That's what we're saying.
But you know what? But wouldn't it actually, like according to that scripture, wouldn't it make sense from the real discovery to be in Christ Jesus, because that's when the truth is revealed.
Sir, wouldn't it be a better discovery to find out Jesus looked just like you, sir?
Not only
do he look like you, but he's from your same nationality.
I agree. And you know what? 100%.
Isn't that big? Wouldn't the black people treat each other better if they found out they was Israelites? Do you think black people would shoot themselves and rob each other if they knew that they were the chosen seed of Abraham? Isn't this information valuable?
If I was going off a cliff, and somebody white saved me and kept me from falling over that cliff, or Native American, or any other ethnic, I'm going to be in gratitude to what that person is doing.
But
that's what I'm saying. Like Jesus says, blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. That's what I'm focusing on.
Spirit and truth, sir.
But spirit and truth, though.
You have to spirit and truth. You can't lack the truth.
But he's the embodiment. Because they call Jesus Christ.
That's right.
But you must worship in spirit and in truth. That's not talking about the fact that he's the truth. It's not talking about that. It's talking about the fact that you must worship in spirit and in truth.
And Jesus is.
Please read that so she can hear that.
Wisdom of Solomon, what?
Wisdom of Solomon. Hold on, let him get there, man. Tell him what page number.
66.
Okay.
Go ahead.
14.
And let me tell you, this is going to be perfect, okay? Because it's going to not only tell you what they did, it's going to tell you why they did it and why what we're saying is so important. This scripture right here is going to let us know. Go ahead.
14 and 15. For a father afflicted with untimely mourning, when he hath made an image of his child soon taken away, now honor him as a god,
a dead man. Okay, go ahead.
Which was then a dead man.
Uh-huh.
And delivered to those that were under him ceremonies and sacrifices.
These ceremonies and sacrifices that come with Jesus Christ is different from the Hebrew Israelite Jesus that came from the tribe of Judah. Listen, they taught this. This is the Bible now.
Yeah.
They taught their own thing. Well, where did that happen at, sir? Where was? When did they go into a new land and put this image up? in America. In America. Mm-hmm. And is that not what we enslaved today?
But you know what? Okay, let me
please defend me.
Let me make a statement.
Go ahead.
What you just said.
No, you got it. You go ahead.
Okay, now you remember in John, I think it's in chapter 8, where Jesus made a comment about slavery, like you mentioned slavery. Now, there is a slavery in the flesh.
Are you talking about no slave and no bond, no free? I understand that, but that's not the point.
But he says, but remember, it's crucial because you can be enslaved physically like Israel was in the desert, and they was wandering through the wilderness, but they were still thinking like slaves back in Egypt because they kept complaining to Moses and in Aaron and to God. They kept saying, oh, it was so much better because we could eat grapes and rice and all these different things in that land, and it was so much better there, like it was better being in slavery. But the same thing applies to spiritual rebirth, because it's like this. You can be born again, walking in freedom, learning how to walk like Christ, or still be enslaved by it. All those different things that are really insignificant compared to Jesus Christ and being saved and walking in the newness of life. That's what I'm trying to say.
It's real funny because like everything you're saying, you're right. I mean, I'm not disputing any of that, man. Like, I understand the new birth. I understand reborn, and I understand all that. But here's what you're missing. Okay? And you too. Here's what you're missing. You're missing the fact that you are a Hebrew Israelite from the tribe of Judah. Okay? And this was a slave. This was racism at the highest level.
Right.
Okay, so the Bible is going to tell us, it tells us that rituals came along with him. The rituals that this Bible don't back up, like we read about the Christmas tree, sir.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, so if these rituals came with this guy, we not only got to put this guy down, we got to put all of his rituals down.
Right.
We can't worship, we can't celebrate Christmas. We can't celebrate Easter, because you're supposed to be celebrating the Passover. When the lamb, when they put the blood in, you're supposed to celebrate.
Now,
what does egg and a bunny rabbit have to do with Jesus Christ?
And I agree with you. And you know what? I won't dispute that. You're right.
Do you practice this?
I have.
Okay,
but see, look. Okay,
we got to put that stuff down.
Okay, now let me make a statement. Now, you just said something extremely powerful and profound. Now, you mentioned celebrating the Passover. But who's the true Passover? That's the thing. It's Jesus Christ.
Sir, it tells us in Deuteronomy to celebrate the Passover throughout all our generations. It never said stop. It never told me to stop celebrating the Passover.
Right, and you know what? When you're breaking that bread and drinking that wine, you're representing the true Passover Lamb, Jesus Christ, because John calls him, "Behold, the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world." When the Holy Spirit descended on Jesus like a dove, that's the true Lamb of God.
What about the crucifix? The crucifix. Do you have a cross in your house?
No, I don't. But I know where you're going with. I hear you. I know where you're going with.
Okay. Right. You're not supposed to create. You're not supposed to create.
Mama, my cross.
Get.
It's just a symbol.
Oh, okay. Well, you're right. Now read that, man. Go pull that up. Oh, where you at? Hold on. Get Exodus 20, man.
Oh yeah.
Get Exodus 20. Oh, let's find out. Let's see what the Bible says about your image or your, what she said it was?
A symbol.
Right. Let's see what the Bible says about a symbol.
Exodus 20, verse 1.
Go ahead.
And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God.
This is what we're trying to establish when we're telling you about putting these customs down. Read on.
Which I brought thee out of the land of bondage, or land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Listen, sir, we're not to have no other gods before him.
Right.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images.
You're not to make what?
Thee any graven image or any likeness of any kind.
Or any likeness of any kind.
That is in heaven above.
That's in heaven above.
Or that is in the earth beneath.
Exodus 20.
Verse 1 and 2.
I'm at 4 right now.
Verse 4. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
So if you have crosses, if you have Christmas trees, if you have Easter egg, Easter bunnies, if you have these things, you are practicing the heathen ways. And the Bible says you got to put them gods down. You got to put them down and follow the holy days. You know what the holy days are, sir?
Yeah, they
Feast of Atonement.
Right.
The Passover. Day of Unleavened Bread.
Yes.
These are the holy days. But let me ask you, all the Christians in America, none of them follow those things, sir.
No, no, but you know what? Okay, I'm going to show you two scriptures. I'm going to show you two scriptures addressing that. Okay, now, for instance, okay, now here's one in James chapter 2. And now I'm going to read this to you. Let me see.
I want to get back to that Apocrypha too, though. I'm going to finish it.
Okay.
James, what?
1 and 2?
Chapter 2.
Okay.
Okay, now, let's start at verse 18, for instance. Like I said, now, this is James addressing a situation regarding faith and works. Now, mm-hmm. anytime he's talking about works, he's always talking about keeping the law.
Right.
That's crystal clear.
Right.
Now, it says...
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah,
that's beautiful,
absolutely. Right.
No,
absolutely.
No, that's beautiful.
Absolutely. See, that, okay, that's good. Now he says, but if someone may well say, you have faith and I have works. But it says, show me your faith without works, the works, and I will show you my faith by my works. It says, you believe that God is one, and you do well. The demons also believe and shudder or tremble. And it says, but are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works is useless? And he's saying that, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up Isaac, his son, on the altar? So you see that faith was working with his works. So see, they go now. He's basically talking, both of them going coinciding together.
So do you think that Abraham didn't have the faith?
He's the father of faith. Everybody knows.
Okay, who taught Abraham?
The Lord himself, because he was.
Brother, you got to go into these mixing books, man. You got to get it. You got to get to the Joseph. You got to get the Josephus. You got to get the Book of Jasper.
Yeah, I have a copy.
Okay, so the book of you got the Book of Jasper.
Jasper, no, but I go online and I read.
Okay, what you have to understand is that Abraham had a father named Terah.
Right. Yes.
Terah was an idolatrous.
Yes, he was.
Mm-hmm. Okay, hold on now. When he was born, the king, which is Nimrod, Nimrod had a dream, a vision of a child being born that's going to overthrow him. Okay? Now, Terah was feared of his son. So what he did was he sent Terah to Noah and Shem. Terah sent Abraham to Noah and Shem. Now, these are the people that survived for the flood, man. Don't you think they had the oracles? Because the Bible, because it tells us that they put the oracles into the ship with the animals.
Yeah.
They put the oracles of the Heavenly Father. So Abraham was taught the oracles. He didn't just start believing because he was just had strong faith. He believed because he was taught by those that survived from the flood.
Yeah.
I mean, mighty faith.
Yeah, I agree with that. That makes perfect
okay,
sense.
Okay, so it didn't just come to him like that. You know what I mean? That's just what they teach. I got the movie of Abraham in my house. It's like he just wandering in the desert and all of a sudden God spoke to him.
No.
That is not what happened. You understand? Yeah. And your movie Moses or the Ten Commandments, what color was that? come on, man. I mean, for real. Let's think about that for a second.
But we're talking about
states and racism.
Right. Especially during that time.
This nation was founded on racism.
So listen, man, we are in captivity in America.
I hear people all the time say, like, yeah, what you just saying about Thanksgiving and all that. I'm like, no, they were killing these Native Americans when they came over here.
So do you celebrate Thanksgiving, though?
I hear white preachers get on the pulpit and say that this nation was founded on Christian principles. That's a lie.
And we know
that's
that we don't accept that.
Y'all act
by no means.
Understand that this nation.
Okay, but you're not understanding who you are.
I'm lost because y'all thought y'all was talking about the cross and
well, I read it.
Well, he was bringing up something in James, which was profound.
Yeah,
great scripture.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like you know, everything. Listen, the way you was taught about this information is incorrect, because the Lord's day is not Sunday, brother. The Lord's day is the Sabbath, okay? And I can prove that to you in the scripture that the Lord's day is the Sabbath day. The scripture that you're talking about that's in Acts, they was counting money, and you can pull it out. Pull it out in action.
Yeah, no,
pull it out in action. They was talking about.
You're not supposed to take an offering.
Right.
You're not supposed to count the money on Saturday.
Yeah.
You know that's supposed to be for the next day.
Yeah. First day of the week. Technically, like working.
Right. Okay. So why out of all 10? Now we're dealing with the 10. I know it was 600.
Uh-huh.
Okay, but I'm talking about the 10. Why in the 10? It's only one scripture that says it's only one commandment that tells you to remember.
Remember.
Yeah.
Remember the Sabbath and keep
because
it holy.
Why? Because he knew that we forget. And he knew that these people would do this. But this is the snare.
But you'll notice something too. Now you'll notice this too. Now, and like I said, just try to take this to heart. You know, because you know now, and yeah, I love all.
Okay,
you, and
you
I appreciate
this.
What you all
do. Let me ask you this.
But okay.
Now,
okay.
Us knowing this, and we all agree.
Right.
What should we do now?
Okay. Now I'm gonna answer that question by addressing what he had just mentioned. Now he talked about that of all those commandments, that's the one regarding the remembrance. But now you'll notice, Jesus says, "I didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it."
Oh,
right.
Which
right,
I know
right.
you all agree.
Matthew 5:17.
Right. Exactly. Now, but you'll notice what he said. They asked him, "What's the greatest commandment in the law?" He could have named any one of those laws, but he named two of them.
Why? Because the Ten Commandments are broken up in two parts. One, the first part is talking about serving God, and the other is talking about serving your brother. So he said, I'm going to wrap up all the commandments in two. Love thy God with all thy heart,
exactly.
and love thy brother.
And with those two commandments
right.
falls.
All the 10.
Yes,
all the 10 go in today.
See,
but do we throw away the 10, though?
But see, that's what I'm saying. We're in full agreement.
But do we throw away the rest of the 10?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. I won't deny it.
Woo!
I'm talking, not us, but I'm talking about, like, people as a whole.
Oh,
like,
okay.
Yeah, they
Oh, okay, okay, yeah, yeah.
Those commandments are crucial. You can't, I mean, like, when it says, you should not steal, you can't do that. Don't have any other guys before me. You still have to obey that.
Okay, but do you go shopping on Saturday?
You have to because the way society is set up.
Yeah.
Okay,
you
but
get
you don't
check on Friday.
You don't have to.
I'll say thank you, y'all, we're in Christ. We're one new human. We're one new person now.
Okay, but Christ said, if you love me, then keep my commandments.
Right.
What commandments was that?
To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And
okay, but that in what I'm saying is those two are embodying the 10 because why? Because you can split the 10 commandments in two. The first half is dealing with the loving of God, and it outlines specifically how, and it shows you how to love God.
Mm-hmm.
And the other two shows you how to love your, the other five shows you how to love your brother.
Absolutely.
That's why he broke it up in two.
Yeah.
It was not to say to follow these two and that's it.
Do you believe that the New Testament wants us to follow all the laws from the Old Testament?
Ain't that what Matthew 5:17 say, man?
I come not to pay with
you. He said not one jot. And then he said, if you break even the least commandment,
the commandment.
Exactly.
Okay, that's not the point. The point is when you repent, and you come and you turn, when you turn from your ways.
Right.
What where are you turning to? Wait. What where are you turning to?
To Jesus Christ.
Okay, and Jesus Christ says, if you love me. So you telling me that his only commandments are those two?
But we can't keep them. That's
that don't make sense when he said 5:17.
But I'm gonna show you something. I'm gonna show you what he said though.
That's not the point though. You can repent.
But no, but you remember something that Paul said. Now you just mentioned that. You know something that Paul said. Paul says, but if I'm loving my brother, isn't that the fulfillment of the whole law? Because it's really like Paul addressed this many times.
How do you love your brother though? What scripture do you go to find out how to do that?
You can go Old and New Testament.
No, brother, the commandments is what we're dealing with,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So how? What do you go to read?
How do
I love my brother? So if I come and I steal from you, but in my heart I say in my mind I love him. You know what I'm saying?
No
but
that a man gives his life for his friend. That's
right.
The greatest love.
Matthew 22. You can go to 1 Corinthians 4.
If you love me, keep my commandments. Not one. Not one. All of them.
Right.
All of them.
No.
I was making a point to the fact of what tells me, what gives me the outline and the guidelines to execute those two commandments that you're leaning on.
Okay.
What tells me?
Okay. Let me show you a scripture. Let me show you a scripture regarding that.
Were you going to the fruit?
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm. I think that would be
you going to the fruit.
Right.
But so you're saying that supersedes the 10?
Well, yes, it does, because Jesus said it. Jesus says of all the law. He didn't say
you're not dealing with Matthew 5 and 17, though.
But that's what he said.
Go get that, man, because, see, they're missing that.
No, but okay.
He knows it.
Okay, but I'm going to show you. Now, notice what it says here. Now, it says in Galatians chapter 5, which is the one that you just addressed. Mm-hmm. Now, it's verse 20. Now, notice specifically what it says. It says, notice, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now notice, it says, against such things there is no law. Now Paul said that. Why did he say that?
Listen, I don't care what Paul says. I'm going to tell you what Jesus Christ himself says. Paul don't supersede Jesus, okay?
But Paul is, he's a follower of Jesus.
He don't supersede. He can't come and change anything.
No, but he's expounding what the letter, that's what he's talking about.
You're
that's
right. What Jesus, but what about this? For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, listen, okay, sir, till heaven and earth pass. Right. This is Jesus Christ. Is heaven and earth still here, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall no wise pass from the law.
Right.
But what law is he talking about? Is he talking about the two laws over here?
He's talking about all the laws.
All 613, which is absolutely right.
Which includes love. Now, mm-hmm. I'm gonna tell you why. I'm gonna tell you why specifically. Why he made that comment? The reason he said that, and it's true, because all his law is holy, it's pure, it's righteous. But can any man, human, really keep it? Because he says if you break one of those laws...
My laws are not grievous.
He says if
you... Paul tell you that his laws are not grievous.
Okay, you know,
what does that mean? I can keep the commandment.
But
I can.
But you know what he said?
I can keep every one of them. I don't eat pork. I don't eat shrimp. I don't eat lobster. I honor the Sabbath.
But what about covenant? That's a mental thing. That's in your heart. You can't. You really can't do an act to stop covenant.
Say, brother, the Bible tells you to put your head down. Okay? The Bible tells me to put my head down. So I'm not finna be covet. I don't covet because I don't look at women like in that way.
Why did God send Jesus if we could keep the law? What was the purpose of
it? That's a great question. That's a great question. Because we was going and we was about to go into captivity in 70 AD. Okay, in order for us to go into captivity and break the laws, because the Gentiles that was put over us forced us to break the law, in order for him to call those same people back, he had to make the sacrifice where you can be forgiven and repent. John ushered in repentance.
Right, because in the ancient times, you was killed for your sin.
You was killed. So now, right. So Jesus said, listen, don't kill him.
Put to death for your sin.
No, you because know what? That's not true. That's not true. I'm going to prove it.
What's not true?
I'm not being put to death for your sins.
So you can get stoned today for your sins?
Not by humans. Now, I'm talking about the final judgment.
We're not talking about the final judgment. We're talking about slavery. We're talking about the transition to the slave trade.
Okay, now I'm going to go with slavery. Now, okay, this is Jesus saying this now. Jesus says, he was speaking to the Jews or the Israelites, the descendants of Judah. And now so Jesus was saying to the Jews who had believed in him. Now, he's talking about those who believed. Not all of them believed in him, but this particular group did. And he says, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free, which I know you all are like familiar with that scripture. Then
you should know the truth.
Right.
Is this truth? I'm gonna ask you, ma'am. Is that true? Okay.
I want to die there.
Okay, but see, what you ain't understanding is he did laws and oracles came with him.
Right?
Go ahead.
Okay.
That you're still keeping.
This is what Jesus said.
Like that you're still keeping though.
But it says they answered him very clearly, which is from a Jewish mindset, this would be a notable answer. It says, we are Abraham's descendant and have never been enslaved to anyone. But it says, how is it that you will make us become free? Now notice, they're talking about physical. We're descendants of Abraham. We've never been enslaved to anyone. But Jesus is talking about something entirely different. He says, truly, truly I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. Now he's talking about sin, law breaking. And it says, because we have that nature in us. And it says, the slave does not remain in a house forever. So he's letting them know that. It says, the son remains forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Now that's the true freedom. That's the true freedom he's talking about. That only comes through Jesus Christ. It'll come through obeying the law. Because no one can keep the law.
That's not true, sir. How can you say no one can keep the law when Jesus said, keep the law? Paul, that's a contradiction.
No. He says, keep my commandments. Now, the commandment he's talking about is
the law, statutes,
and commandments. So what about the scripture? What about when it says in John, in the book of John, I've come not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me.
Correct. That's right.
Wait a minute. No, sir. It can't be right if you're telling me that Jesus changed something.
Okay, now, what's his greatest...
Malachi 1 and 3 says, I change not.
Right.
So that Jacob is not consumed.
You know why the fact that that's profound? It's because he can't change. That's the reason why God had to put all of our sins and pour out his wrath on his son in our place. Because just like I was telling you earlier, you can't break the law without a penalty being put out. So Jesus, somebody had to pay the fine. I mean, we couldn't do it because we broke it. He said, if you offend at one point, you're guilty of all of it. So we're guilty. But God had to send his son, who volunteered to come in our place on that cross and poured out his wrath on his son with his atoned blood for us. And not just for us, but for all humanity.
So at that point, what changed? After what was
done? It
was the establishment of the New Testament,
which is
the new covenant.
With not just the Israelites, but for all people. But
we read
in Hebrews who the law was. I mean, who was it with? It never said nothing about Gentile. I'm not talking about Ephesians, but
he said the two becoming one. But even in Revelation, it says, "Whoever wills, let him come to drink of the water of life freely." Salvation. As a matter of fact.
So you got two responsibilities. The Israelites have a responsibility, and the Gentiles have. If you go into Romans 11, it tells you not to boast against the natural branches.
Absolutely.
Okay, right. Because if you boast, then you're not boasting of your history.
Right.
Okay, so when they talk about the Ten Commandments and the splitting of the sea and what David and Solomon did, the Gentiles, if they boast of that, they are not boasting of their history.
It wouldn't even profit the Gentiles to do it because the Gentiles were outcasts. They didn't have any promises or any commitment.
Are you a Gentile?
I'm a child of God.
That's not answering the question, sir. It tells us in the oracles.
One new person.
So who performed the oracles? Who performed the ritual rites in church? Who do that?
Okay, you talking about for the Jewish believers?
We just read that.
You talking about the
who's supposed to stand up and deliver this word and stand up in the congregation? Not only that, he's supposed to have a holy garment on with ribbons of blue and tassels.
Who was the Jewish priest?
See where you're going off?
But who was the greatest high priest? It was Jesus Christ. Hebrews speaks highly of that.
But who is to perform the rites of church service? Who's supposed to do that?
Well, you got preachers or
overseers. So you're wrapping everybody, a black and a white man, in as priest?
No. There's only one.
Can another nation be priest?
It's only no other nation. Only the people of God.
Only the people that was given the oracles to the laws. Psalms 147:19. What is it? 147:19. This is a distinction, man, because you have to see that everybody can't just stand up and read this book. How you gonna tell me, and you're not an Israelite,
right?
How you gonna tell me about this book?
But see, that's the thing. Jesus came and proclaimed the ultimate message.
Then why do it say in the New Testament that the oracles are supposed to be done by Israelites?
Now, you're talking about Old Testament.
I'm talking about New Testament, sir. Well, it said in the New Testament, Jesus read it.
He says, go out and proclaim the message. He says, make disciples of all nations.
Wait a minute. He said, I'm not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
And he was.
The lost sheep of the house of Israel.
I won't doubt it. He was. That's who he came to first.
That's what the Gentiles should help do. Right. The Gentiles should help bring the lost sheep of the house of Israel back to God.
I agree. That's what we're
trying to do. So they can be saved.
That's what we're trying to do.
But you don't even know who the lost sheep are, sir. How can you do that?
But
these are the lost sheep.
Anybody who's lost.
No. I'm not talking about anybody. He said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of Israel.
Right.
Okay, because if you don't know who Israel is, how can you then help them come back to God?
Two reasons. One, the leading of the Holy Spirit. Who knows? And number two,
what is the Holy Spirit?
He's the third person in the Godhead. He's the Lord God.
So
give me Isaiah 11, man.
Yeah, because the Holy Spirit is
not. Yeah, because he said he spoke in tongues too. So let's deal with that. Let's deal with that. First Corinthians 14.
Right.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 14. You give me Isaiah 11, and you give me
Isaiah 11 and 1.
John, give me St. John 6 and 63.
And when you look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18.
Okay, hold on a second. Can we get this real quick and then we get it out?
It goes with what
that.
Y'all was saying.
Okay. St. John 6 and 63. But let me get yours first. Isaiah. Let's see what the Holy Spirit is.
Okay.
And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem.
Hold on. Okay, this is Isaiah 11 and 2.
Okay, sorry, 11 and 2.
Got it. Okay, go ahead.
And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom.
Spirit of wisdom.
And understanding.
And understanding.
The Spirit of counsel.
The Spirit of counsel.
And might.
And might.
The Spirit of knowledge.
The Spirit. Wait a minute. Knowledge of what? Knowledge of self? Knowledge of who you are? Knowledge of your history? Knowledge of what was you doing before you came on the slave ships? Right. Go ahead.
That's
read.
The Holy Spirit.
Read.
And the fear of the Lord.
In the fear of the Lord. Now give me what you got, brother. St. John 6 and 63.
Okay. 6 and 63.
What was that John verse?
John 6 and 63. Are you there, brother?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profits nothing.
The flesh profits nothing. It's the Spirit that gives us. Go ahead.
The words that I speak.
Listen, sir.
You, they are spirit.
The words that I speak to you, sir, is the Spirit. Not speaking in tongues or some sort of Holy Ghost outburst or some sort of gyrations and these things. Listen, this is what I was raised in. I don't know if that's what you do. No. I'm not saying that, but saying this is what I was raised in.
Okay, let me address that.
Okay.
Then. Okay, now you mentioned the speaking in tongues.
Right.
You mentioned the gyration and all that, which we don't do that. But
so hold on. Let me ask you. So whenever you do speak in tongues, is there a translator?
Yeah. Yeah, at our church it's
I just wanted to ask that because that's important.
I would love to see that. I mean, listen, you can't translate. You can't just say, I know what you're saying, and the person that's speaking don't know.
Trust me, it's possible.
Okay, but listen, how do I know, as someone that's just in the audience, how do I know that the guy that's translating is not just saying his own words?
Can you go ahead and make a comment?
Okay. Now, if you want to go ahead with that, you said you had one for me. Ephesians?
Oh, okay. Yeah. It's just about... I'm going to read two things.
Mm-hmm.
I know y'all heard of the armor of God.
You're right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep.
I want to read verse 12. Okay. It says, this is not a wrestling match against a human opponent. We're wrestling with rulers, authorities, the powers who govern the world of darkness, and spiritual forces that control the heavenly world. I want to get that out there for, first. And then on verse 18, it says, pray in the Spirit in every situation. Use every kind of prayer request there is for the same reason, be alert. Use every kind of effort and make every kind of request for all God's people. And that's just talking about praying in the Spirit when you ask them about things.
No. I understand praying in the Spirit, but what is the Spirit?
Now, specifically, the Holy Spirit is the third person in the Godhead. The Creator, the Lord.
Where it says the three that bear witness in the heavens.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Do you also believe Jesus is God?
Without question.
Oh, man, okay.
So what about the Lord's Prayer?
What about
the Lord's Prayer? So he's speaking to himself?
No. The only way you can really understand it, are any one of you married?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
It's the same way. You got two individuals. The two become one. One flesh. God sees you as one flesh, like he sees me and my wife as one flesh. We're two individual persons, but still one person, like one flesh. Well, that's how God is, the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. when you read Genesis chapter 1, you see, let us make man in our image after our likeness. He's speaking in, you know, he's speaking more to one
person. So who made the heavens and the earth?
The Lord God.
So Jesus didn't make the heavens and earth.
Jesus did, because it says it in John, the Gospel of John, chapter right. 1. It says,
okay, so when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, who was he praying to, himself?
No, he was praying to the Father.
Okay, he's so very specific. So what about in John where it says, the Father hath given a life unto himself, and the Son has a life unto himself.
Correct. Correct. That's why Jesus says, the works that you see me do bear witness of myself, that the Father is working through me.
Because that the Father is working through him. Right. He states throughout the whole book of John that he makes it very clear that he is not the Father.
Yeah, he says, right, right. And
yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's two individuals just like us, but one flesh.
No, but y'all have the same mindset. No. That's what the one is.
Yeah, y'all in one consist.
Y'all in one consist. They can sit at a table and have an agreement. That's the one.
You in one mind.
Right, but here's a prime example too. Like, for instance, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. It says, it talks about the coming Messiah. It said, he's going to come, they're going to call him the Mighty God, the Eternal Father, the Prince of Peace.
Where's that
at? His kingdom is no end. It's in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And it's talking about that specific child who was born in Jerusalem that day, or in Bethlehem. It says, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given. Now it's talking about the Son of David, clearly. It says, and the government will rest on his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, the Prince of Peace. There will be no end of
his increase. So what is God's name?
It's a tetragrammaton. Tetra meaning four. Grammaton is Greek for grammar, which is where we get grammar for. But it would translate YHWH, the four Hebrew consonants. We add the A and the E, make it Yahweh, but it's actually YHWH. That's his real name. And of course, his real name is Jesus Yeshua.
Well, do you understand that God is God can be for the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And Satan.
Correct.
Okay, hold on. You're right. Hold on. So, but in the Hebrew,
right,
the word is Elohim. Okay? Yes. So in the Hebrew, Elohim can like when it said
Satan is the God of this world.
John's 1 and 1.
Right. Which is that's true. Right. I mean that is true.
Right.
Humans have been addressed as being God in the scripture.
Exactly. So God just because it's saying right. God right there, okay, it doesn't mean that. It makes a difference. Go to Colossians 1:13.
Now you realize. Now I know where you're going with this one, but you realize in the New Testament Jesus received worship. He also received praise.
But he's our king.
Right, but he's God. Only God. He himself said to the devil in the desert, what did he say? He said, like the devil told him, if you fall down and worship me, all will be yours. And then he says, you should worship the Lord your God only, and him shall you serve. But then you turn around in a couple of scriptures, and he's receiving worship. But he just said, you should worship the Lord your God and serve me only. Either he's God or he's not.
But you have to understand that the Heavenly Father, it tells you in Daniel's, that he sat upon the throne, and that he had gave all power and all praise to his Son.
Right.
Okay, so the Son is supposed to then...
Because they're one.
Okay, so the Son is the... No. They're in one consent. You must go into the Hebrew. You must go into the Hebrew to understand that was talking about one consent. How do I know that? Because it tells me in Colossians that Jesus had a beginning. He had a creation. He was created. But guess what? The Father was never... Let's read it.
Right.
Go pull it out, man. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Colossians.
Colossians 1 and 13. Let's see. I thought you said you knew where I was going with that, brother. I thought you said you knew that. Let's get that, man. Colossians 1 and 13.
Okay, Colossians 1 and 13.
Who have delivered us from the power of darkness.
Go ahead.
And have translated us into the kingdom of his dear son.
Wait a minute. Now, that's basically stating what you were stating, right?
Uh-huh.
But this is the Father saying that he had translated the kingdom to his son.
Right.
Why he didn't translate it to himself?
Because that's the second person in the Godhead.
All right, go ahead.
14. In whom we have redemption through his blood.
Who are we talking about?
Christ.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
Even the forgiveness of sin.
Right, go ahead.
Who is the image of the invisible God.
Go ahead.
Right. The firstborn.
Listen, sir.
Of every creation.
The firstborn of every creation. So he had a beginning.
You know what that word?
He had a beginning, and Jesus the one created the heavens and earth. Jesus is the one that was dealing with Adam and Eve in the garden. That was Jesus.
Correct. But you, that's why he said, and also before Abraham was, I am. You know
exactly
because he's God. But
whoa! But, no!
And he made that crystal clear. He's God. That's why Thomas, when he seen him that morning on the eighth day after the resurrection, he said, John chapter 20 verse 28, he called it, like he says when he seen his hands, his nail prints. He says, "My Lord and my God." Jesus could have rebuked him and said, "Well, I'm not God," but he didn't, and he received that worship.
But that's until you understand that God means Elohim. you understand? You have to understand that okay. God means Elohim.
But I'm gonna go to a point of what this scripture is talking about. When you read English translations, a lot of times they translate Greek words to try to make them simplify in English. The word firstborn is different from the way it's meaning in modern English. Because a firstborn, like it's talked about, like us is, oh, well, I'm the firstborn son, or I'm the firstborn daughter. Well, the firstborn is a title meaning that you have birthrights. Just like Abraham had birthrights.
Well, that would make sense until you read the next line. Okay? Okay. It says the firstborn of all creation, sir.
Right. Right. That's what it's talking
no,
about.
No. You're saying you can be considered the firstborn. It's not a mistake. The thing said that he was the first of everything that was made.
But if you look at the Greek, yeah, exactly, and it is, because he's before him all things existed. Like he was first before all things.
I think y'all are agreeing on everything.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
No, we're not agreeing because Jesus is not God.
Yes, God.
Okay, so we're not in agreement.
Yes.
Okay. Let me get this scripture. It says St. John's 5:26. Let me get Luke 18:19.
John.
The same John.
First John and the second John.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And plus, like I said, I know you're familiar with this scripture. Like for instance,
you get Luke 18:19.
Like the woman that Jesus forgave the sins. Now the Jews was crystal clear on what he was talking about. She was crying at his feet. Jesus says, "Your sins are forgiven." Oh, well, he's blaspheming.
Ooh, the Bible said that he gave all power to his son. Let me get up.
But see, that's what I'm saying. Jesus, his origin, that's who he is. He even spoke of that in John chapter 17 when he says, I existed. I was with you before the world was even made, before the world even came into existence. Because he was before all things.
Well, let's see. Get
okay.
Get there. 5:26 and Luke 18:19.
John 5:26.
Yeah.
For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself.
Go ahead.
And hath given him authority to
execute judgment. That means to give forgiveness, sir. Because that was his right that was given to him by the Father. How can the Father give himself something? how can I be handing this to myself? I can't hand this to myself.
No, but see, that's what I'm saying. See, like you're thinking, like when I say one God, you're thinking one individual person. But it's just like I was saying.
Are you speaking like of the Trinity?
Correct.
What, is the word Trinity written of in the Bible?
No.
So,
but the concept of Trinity is crystal clear in Scripture. You can't get around it. Because when you read...
I understand that there's three that bear witness in heaven. I understand
chapter 1, verse 26.
What about 1 John? What about John's 1:1? Read
right,
that.
Right. In the beginning was the Word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's get that.
That's crystal clear. That's
okay. It is right. Crystal clear. But what about the next line? Go ahead, get that.
In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with God.
Wait a minute. Is he schizophrenic? Why would he say... No. Why would he say the Word was with him?
Right.
I mean, is he off his rocker or something? He can't distinct the difference?
He's confirming the truth because...
No. He said he's with him. He's with him. If I come and he asks me who's with me and I say my own name or I say I'm with myself, that's not proper.
Well,
that's not proper. The Bible says I am not the author of confusion.
Correct.
Read on.
Go ahead.
Verse 2. Oh, I didn't finish. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
The Word was the Elohim. Right. Do you understand? Yes. The Elohim could consist of the Holy Spirit, the Son, and the Father.
Okay, okay, now notice, this is a beautiful scripture. And now I want to break it down a little bit. Okay, now, when it says, in the beginning was the Word. Now, clearly, the Word is a personal pronoun. It's a person. Clearly. Because verse 2 says, he. Okay. Now,
Okay.
Now, if that's the case, now you just said it. Now, in the beginning was the Word. Now, you go down to verse 14. Because we know that that's God. Because he said it. In the beginning was the Word. Now, and then on a little part of that scripture says, and the Word was God. Okay, now go down to verse 14. It says, the Word, God, the personal pronoun, was made flesh. He became flesh.
Wait a minute. So that lets me understand that the Father did not become flesh. Do you see? The first one was a distinction between the two. The Word was with God. Then it says right here that the word that was with him, the Word had became flesh, right? Not the Father.
The personal pronoun, the Son. Yeah, because you got the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Yeah.
Okay.
The one true God. I mean, that's crystal clear. That's crystal clear.
So you do believe there is a Father, a Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
Right. Okay. Yes. Not just Jesus is God.
I believe that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that's the Godhead. That's the
So you believe God. That the Son is equal with the Father?
I believe that. Yeah, clearly.
He said, I and my Father are one.
No, yeah. He said that means he said that we are on one accord. I come down here to do the will of him who sent me. I'm not come to do my own. Yeah, what does it mean when I say I'm not come to do my own will?
But see, that's the thing, though. See, like,
is he schizophrenic,
no,
sir?
No, but this is what it's.
I mean, is he off his rocker?
He explains that. he explains that in Philippians. It talks about that because it talks about how when the Son came down, he set aside all his rights as God, and humbled himself and became a servant. Mm-hmm. That's crystal clear. He could have destroyed.
Okay, then why did he say this? Why did he say this? Real quick. Why did he say this? I mean, he really got to be going off to say this. Let me get, Luke, you got 18:19? Read that, man.
Luke 18:19.
Hey, can I turn this fan on? The Bobby?
Oh, no, you're fine. Yeah, that's fine.
No, that's fine.
Luke 18:19. And Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good?
Listen, sir, is he schizophrenic? I'm saying, is he off his rocker, though? Why would he say?
That's why the Jews thought Jesus was crazy. Yeah. That's why they put him on that cross.
Yeah.
No, it's not, ma'am. That is not why they put him on the cross. They put him on the cross. No.
They said, you're saying that you're God. That was the main reason. And then they even put, the Roman soldiers put Jesus, the king of the Jews.
Okay, but he didn't say the God of the Jews. You have to understand that. Because why? Because Jesus never said he was the God. He's the King. When we go into the kingdom of heaven, we all are going to worship the Father in the kingdom.
Okay.
We're not going to all come to worship Jesus Christ. Yes, we are.
Because in Revelation, it says that clear as day, it says they're going to worship the Father and the Lamb. That's Jesus is the Lamb of God.
Okay, but
they're going to worship him.
Why would they mention both of them?
Because they're
No. Think about that. Why would he mention both of them if they're the same person? That don't make sense. Why are you saying the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit?
But notice, now you keep saying the same person. Me and my wife are not the same person. We're two individual persons, but we're one flesh. You got one God, three persons.
Why would he say, why are you calling me good? It's nobody good, not even me. Not even Jesus Christ is good, correct. Except the Father.
No, this is what he's talking about.
Wait a minute, that's what he said. Read it again.
And that is what he's talking about, but you notice this. Now, when he said that, that man was looking at his physical form. He was calling him good teacher. He was looking at his physical form as a person.
What does that mean?
Well, it means that because God did become a man. When that Pharisee was looking at him, he was looking at a person. He was thought like, okay, well, this is a good person, a good teacher. But he wasn't basing that statement on the fact that he was God. He didn't, because that man.
Sir, we can't. Listen, the Bible says there's no such thing of private interpretation.
Right.
We got to take the scriptures for what it says. Read it again, sir.
And Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good? None is good.
Wait a minute. So if he says none is good, isn't that including himself?
He's basing it solely because it's self-denial. He's looking straight
to the Father. So if I say none is good except the Father. Right? So if none is good except the Father is the only person that's good, and he's including himself, why wouldn't he say no one's good except me and the Father?
If that's the case, then you gotta throw out Isaiah 9:6.
No, I don't, because I understand the Elohim.
Yes,
I understand the Elohim.
No, because it's talking about that child who came being God, their eternal Father, everlasting. He said the Prince of Peace, the Mighty God. I mean, those are titles.
You're missing it.
No.
The Hebrew, in the Hebrew, you must go to the Hebrew, because this is the best that we have. Okay?
Right.
But particular things can gain more understanding by going into the Hebrew. I would not understand what I understood until I realized that when it said that in John 1:1, in the beginning was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Right.
I would never understood that until I realized that the Elohim was talking about these three that you're talking about.
Correct.
But when he said that there's none good but the Father, he was not talking about the Elohim. He was talking about the Father.
Okay.
So if I say I'm the Elohim, and the Holy Spirit is the Elohim. Now, we understand the Holy Spirit is a feminine. You do understand that, right?
Well, let's put it like this. Now, you said he was talking about the Father, okay? But notice he didn't mention the Holy Spirit either. He only was referring to himself in the flesh form. Notice that. He didn't say, well, he could
have... How was he referring to himself? Break that down for me, sir.
He says, no one is good except God. Uh-huh. So, he wasn't addressing himself as being, like, good, but he...
No, sir. The man said, you're a good man.
Right.
And then, if you tell me, listen... I'm not, no one's good except the Father. How can you interpret that in a different way?
He didn't say that, though. He said, no one is good except God.
Is that what he said? He said the Father,
said, why,
sir.
He said, why callest thou me good?
There's no one good except the Father,
except
sir.
Except God, yeah.
No, except the Father.
And who's the Father?
The Father is in heaven who has no
except
shape.
God.
No one has seen the shape of the Father.
Right.
So how can you then call Jesus God?
Because Jesus receives worship. He forgives sins.
Well, you just read to me in Isaiah scripture that says that it was given to him.
Thomas called him God, John 20:26.
He called him the Elohim.
That's right.
See that? See how you're missing it?
He wasn't calling him the Father.
He wasn't calling him the Father when he called him God.
As a matter of fact, let's go deeper. Actually, like, let's say Isaiah 44, when God constantly addresses himself as I am. John 8:58.
Let me get Proverbs 30:4. Go ahead.
Matter of fact, you go to Revelation 1. Jesus himself, the Son of Man, who's coming in the clouds. Mm-hmm. He says, I am the first and the last.
The beginning and the end.
So what about Colossians? What about Colossians that said he was the... What about Colossians that said he was the beginning? He was the beginning of creation.
Why did he say that? Because he was there at creation. What he formed creation.
Because he was the first one created.
No. Because Jesus...
Wait a minute. He wasn't the first one created?
No.
Colossians is a lie?
No. In Isaiah, it says that before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me. There's only one God, the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. Genesis 1:26. Let us make man in our image.
So when you say Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are you making differences? Hold on. Are you separating the Father and the Son? Are you separating the Holy Spirit and the Father?
Persons. Because when he was getting baptized in the Jordan
River, which means a separate.
In whom we have redemption.
It's cold out there.
In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins.
That's correct.
Go ahead.
Who is the image of the invisible
God? Wait a minute. Who is the image of the invisible God?
Okay,
when you see me, you seen the Father.
Right.
Because I was made by the Father.
What do you think Jesus meant when he says, when you see me, we see the Father? I mean, like, what do you think that means?
Because what he just read.
But, I mean, what do you think it means?
I'm telling you what it means. Oh. What he just read.
Okay.
I am the image of the invisible God.
Meaning what? Like, when he says that.
That if God were to have a form, his form would be what I look like.
It means this. The characteristics of the Father is going to be in the Son. Jesus said that to Philip.
Exactly.
When he was sitting among the table
exactly.
at the Passover. He was telling him, he says, have I been this long with you, Philip, and you not know me? He who has seen me has seen the Father.
Right.
Because all the deeds like love, grace, forgiveness, reaching out to the poor, the needy, all those different things, those attributes, everything that the Father is in the Son.
Wait a minute.
This whole thing.
See, what you're missing is this. Jesus created life.
Right.
Jesus did that.
Right.
Okay, so he had a love for the people himself.
Right.
And the Father made everything, and the Father have a love for everything, but the Son also have his own love.
Correct.
Why? Because he the one that was dealing with Adam and Eve. He the one that was dealing with the for profits and all that. That was the word being sent.
Correct. That's exactly right.
Wait.
That's right.
Wait. The word was what? Sent.
Exactly. That's why I said it, like he said, let there be light. The word, Rhema. Yeah.
So when it said let there be light, did it just snap on like that?
Not until he spoke it and said let there be light, and then that's when light came.
So what was Jesus' job?
He's the word. He was creating. That's what. He was the creator.
So if he was the creator, read that, brother.
What we got? 16.
Yeah.
Oh, the firstborn of every creation.
The firstborn of every creation, man. This was Jesus, man.
Now, when you...
But it was not the Father. When you mean... The Father had to use the Son in order to execute the ability to create the earth with a physical hand.
Well, why would he have to do that if he's God? Now, just think about what you're saying. There's only one creator.
He had to do that because he had a plan that the Son from the beginning would be sent into the earth. The Word was made flesh.
But think about what you're saying, though. Think about really what you're saying. Because... if I'm a created being, which I am, because he spoke me into existence,
it's to uplift the Son. That's why he needs. It's to uplift the Son.
I don't have
the
power to create. But a creator doesn't create himself. Because the Lord says, before me there was no God formed, there should be none after me. So what's the whole concept of Jesus then?
So when you're making a clay pot, do you have to touch that clay?
I would have to, yes.
Okay, so if I wanted to uplift my apprentice,
uh-huh.
Right, and somebody's buying a big time vase for me, but I don't make it. I let my apprentice make it.
Right.
Why? Not to do what? To bring that apprentice up, to uplift the apprentice. So when I say, listen, all worship and praise and the whole kingdom of the earth, the kingdom is the earth. Okay, so it, the whole earth, in order for them to show reverence to the Son, which who I lifted up. If you don't have the Son, you don't have nothing. You cannot say the Father is the Son because the Father has lifted up the Son. Now you're taking away from what he gave to
exactly.
the Son.
But see, you're saying exactly what we're saying, though. That's what I'm saying.
No, you're saying God is Jesus is God. I'm not saying that.
But see, when you're saying that, you're missing the chronology of what we're saying, in the context of what we're saying.
Okay.
There's one God, no doubt about it.
Which is the Father.
Which is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're saying, the Trinity, the Godhead.
I'm telling you that the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are not equal. You have the Father that's up, and then you have the Son,
who's the head of man?
Jesus said, I am a
Christ.
Father.
And who's the head of Christ?
The Father.
Oh, wait a minute. Yes.
That doesn't change
it. It changed a lot for me.
Let me show you how. I'm going to show you how. It's just like when you go to the military. You got a general. Soldiers, sergeants, they're still same people. They're still equally people. They just have different authority. That's all. That's the only difference between the Father and the Son.
No. Okay, if there's a difference, then how can you say the Son has authority equal with the Father?
Jesus said that. Jesus said that. And I look at his deeds, the things that he did, and what he said. He raised the dead.
He's the resurrection. All of God lives in Christ's body, and God has made you complete in Christ.
You until
now. All of God lives in Christ's body.
Correct.
How can that be?
Unless he's the Lord God.
Colossians chapter 2, verse 9.
Read it again.
Colossians chapter 2, verse 9. All of God lives in Christ's body.
All of God lives in Christ's body.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was sent by the Father. Come on now.
Yeah.
That doesn't even make sense.
It does. It wouldn't make sense to like a person, like let's say a person who was like just unbeliever. But it makes perfect sense to a believer because that makes sense because Jesus would have to be because the fact that his blood can atone for humanity and be perfect.
See, y'all missing the scripture that said I and the Father, I did not come to do my own will. What's that mean, sir?
He said, I didn't come to do my will, but the will of the Father. What was the Father's will? For the people to believe on the Son. For what? For the supreme sacrifice of atonement.
Right.
That had to be done because no human could do it.
So how are you then coming back and telling me that God is Jesus? Jesus is the God.
Because that's God's blood that was poured out on Calvary.
Man, it's a distinct difference. You cannot say that, man.
Yes, you can.
No.
No human, no man, even Adam couldn't forgive sins. Only Christ's blood, which is God's blood, pouring through him, Because there's no forgiveness of sins without blood.
Okay, let's get back to this let's get back to this song, Wisdom of Solomon, real quick about this imposter.
Okay. Okay. When you guys get on stuff and I kind of get on it, and then it's like, oh well, I'm not understanding, or I'm forgetting that one, and you go to another one, so I'm not understanding a lot of stuff that is going on.
Because they keep interrupting each other,
and it's like. I'm
well, we're actually not we're not staying on a topic long enough and breaking it down together because we all have an advanced knowledge. So whenever we speak about something, he's going right to another verse, or he's going right into another verse that pertains to it.
But being that you don't have
the base knowledge, right. You're kind of confused on where we're
Listen,
going
ma'am,
with this.
The Bible
but,
tells,
but I can deal with that.
The Bible tells us to contend for the faith. Mm-hmm. It also tells us. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
And it says, be careful not to let anyone rob you of this faith through a shallow and misleading philosophy.
Mm-hmm. Right. So what you believe that my philosophy is misleading?
No,
with the origin of everything that you were talking about from the genealogy and everything, that was right on key. But okay. Like I said, but it's just that. Like our thing was that it has to be Jesus Christ. That's the main purpose. That was the Father's purpose.
If that's the main purpose, sir, why wouldn't you want to know his identity, sir?
This identity should be important.
His identity.
But he said it. He said my identity.
But here's what you don't know. Here's what you don't know. Read that for me, man. In Wisdom of Solomon.
Okay.
Where
we at?
Wisdom of Solomon 14 and 15. You know what I mean? Because you cannot have salvation without identity. You gotta have the identity of Christ. You gotta have the identity of the Israelites. The Bible says that the gates of heaven has the name of the 12 tribes of Israel.
Yes, it does.
Okay, mm-hmm. So you cannot disregard Israel.
No, you can't.
It tells you that nine. It tells you okay, but you don't realize that you are an Israelite, sir. See, that's what I'm saying.
You are a chosen seed. He looked down to Shem and said, those are the only holy people on earth. So he's going to choose a particular people out of Shem.
The bloodline.
But you know what? See,
you should never say that it doesn't matter.
I'm going to address something you just said, though. Now, God said himself, when they was in the desert, he did tell them this. He says, don't think to yourselves that I'm choosing you because you're some great people or some special people out of all the people on the earth.
Deuteronomy 7 and 6.
Exactly. Right. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm choosing you because, as a matter of fact, he said, to be frank, you're the fewest of all people on earth.
That to show his power.
It was to bring glory to his name and fame to his name, to bring glory to himself.
Right.
And that was his main purpose. It wasn't that they was like a really a special people. It was just that. That's why
So
give me Jeremiah 4. Give me Jeremiah 17 17 and 4, and then I want you to finish that Wisdom of Solomon. But I need you to see this because it's a certain curse that came upon us, okay?
And so we're coming out of the curse.
Because the Bible said it's high time to awake out of sleep.
Yeah.
Jeremiah,
right?
Yes.
Absolutely. Okay. So here's the sleep that we was in. What you finna read?
Okay.
Jeremiah what?
Jeremiah 17 and 4. I'm sorry.
And though even thyself shall discontinue from thy heritage that I gave thee.
That he gave us, man.
And I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in a land which thou knowest not. For ye have kindled a fire in my anger.
Was we brought into a land that we knew not, sir?
You know. Deuteronomy 28:68 says so.
And so now I ask you what your nationality
okay,
is.
But you know who he's talking to, though?
Oh. Oh, okay. Yeah, let's see who he's talking to.
Because you find Jeremiah and Daniel and all many of those prophets that was living in
wait
the same
a minute,
time.
They're prophets.
Yeah, exactly. But they was living in a certain time, and this is the time, because I'm in 568 AD. That's when Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar came in and pulled them out of. They burned Jerusalem and they brought them to the land of Babylon.
Luke 21.
Yes. And see, when they did that, now clearly they was talking about that group of people. At
okay.
That time. But
did we flee? Did we come? Did the slaves? Watch this. Uh-huh. Did the slaves come from Africa?
Yes, they did.
Give me Matthew's 24. Give me Matthew's 24.
You'll notice that some of the slaves were owned by other fellow slaves, other fellow black people too, during that time.
Other Africans?
Yes, they were.
Okay, it tells you in Psalms 83. all the nations that will come against us. Every nation that's outside of Israel will come together. So it's talking about the Hamites, the Africans,
the Arabs,
Chinese.
Okay, these people had their hands in our captivity. And I'm going to prove to you that the children of Israel fled into Africa. Go ahead.
Okay, I do have this one question. I know you watched the Olympics.
Yes, I did.
What was our flag at in the Olympics?
The so-called black man.
We represent USA.
Yeah.
LeBron.
But you got Chinese people. Everybody look Chinese.
You got
Jamaican people. Everybody look Jamaican. Everybody looks the same except for America.
Right.
Isn't that funny, sir?
That's funny.
Well, I won't deny that.
Well, how come we don't have a seat on the Congress?
Why is ain't nobody saying we need to build something for the black man?
Right.
But we do have a president though that's black.
He's not Jewish. He's not an Israelite. He's a Hamite. He's a Hamite.
Yeah. Which is one of the people that was chosen to go against us.
Yeah.
So we can't. We don't take claim to him. He's not of us.
I hear you.
Okay. So let's prove to that. Matthew's 24.
Where we going with this?
To prove that they fled in Africa, and then I want to get this Babylon of Timbuktu, man.
Well, you want to go to Luke 21, right?
Luke 21. What's 21? That's the same. It's the same thing. It's the same thing as Matthew's.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And Jesus went out and departed from the temple.
Hold on. Where you at? Matthew's
24.
Matthew's 24 and
7. That's what we're talking about. It actually starts at 5.
Okay.
24:5, is that what you're going?
Yeah, go ahead.
For many shall come in my name, saying I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
Now, do you believe in a rapture?
I believe in the concept of the rapture. I'm going to tell you what that means, though. I believe there is going to be a catching away, but at the time frame when they're saying the church is going to escape before the tribulation and all that, I don't believe that.
Do you know the Lord's Prayer?
Yes, I do.
Okay, I asked you earlier, where was heaven at?
He's talking about a different
our Father,
realm.
Who art in heaven, thy kingdom come.
Yes.
Thy will be done
on earth as it is in heaven.
So that lets me know that the kingdom that's to come, the kingdom of heaven that we're waiting for, is going to be on earth.
Yeah, no question about that.
Okay.
I'm gonna tell you why I believe that. Which I'm sure, because
another realm. So. I didn't know.
Now Jesus, when he ascended to the right hand of the Father, he did go to a different realm.
Well, yeah, they ascended.
But this is why I believe that. No question about it. Because when you read Luke chapter 1, I think it's verse 35. It talks about Jesus sitting on the throne of David. Now you all are familiar with that scripture,
right?
Okay, now. That was prophesied. Okay, there's a question, which I even get in like different
debates
with some of the people that I talk to about that, but about the rapture and things like that. But it's a lot of people they don't really believe in a literal kingdom here on earth. But it doesn't make sense, because when you read Daniel, there was a literal Babylon, there was a literal Medo-Persian,
mm-hmm,
Greece,
right.
Rome, mm-hmm. And the final kingdom coming, it wouldn't be literal, it didn't make sense. So what I did, I went back and I did a little studying on the throne of David. Now, I know God has a throne in heaven, and Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, but, you know, the throne of David, when you read scripture, it's always been on earth, in Jerusalem.
Right.
So when he says Jesus is going to reign on the throne of David, it would make sense that he would reign on the earth. I mean, that's
beautiful.
Yeah. That is beautiful.
Okay. That's
exactly right.
Yeah.
But see, people, this is not common knowledge, though.
Yeah.
You see, what we're dealing with is to break down the misnomers about misunderstood common knowledge.
Yeah. Right. Because most of our people believe they're Gentiles.
Yeah, they do. They do.
I had a woman tell me she used to be an Israelite. How does that happen?
She was reincarnate.
Yeah.
Now she's a Gentile.
That makes no sense.
That made no sense to me.
Because, see, listen, we were not born into our own existence. We were born into a continuation that's been going on since Adam.
Yeah, yep.
Okay, so how? What movie would you go watch and start in the beginning and not go and ask what happened in the beginning of the movie?
That's true.
What book would you read and start in the middle? Yeah. Okay, so this is the problem that we do as Christians. Why? Because they say we go into the New Testament. Well, listen. When they was walking on the earth, when Jesus was walking, was it a New Testament to quote from?
Not yet.
Okay, so where was that quoting from?
Yeah, for a long time.
Right. So what was they quoting from? The Old Testament. So how can a new believer in 2012 say I only follow the New Testament?
Well, you see where he came from.
Right. That's true.
You need to know what Bible prophecies deal with you. You need to know what prophecy deal with you.
Yeah.
You need to know what prophecy deal with your line of people order for you to understand prophecy in the end time. Now, do you know what a daughter of Babylon is today?
When they speak of the daughter of Babylon, well, mostly most people say Persia or Iran.
So are the Israelites in captivity together, the northern tribes and the southern tribes in Persia?
Yeah, I mean...
They are?
Wait a minute,
look at these people.
Talking about the Medes and the Persians? Or
no, are these people?
You mean modern day?
What side of the world are these people on?
Oh, no, yeah, that's way over... South America.
South America? North America. Hawaii.
Indians.
Yeah.
So... You got two names on there: Gadite, the Native Americans. You got the Mexicans, which are the Issacharites. Okay, and as you go down further south, you pick up all the other tribes. So we are all in captivity together in this western side hemisphere. That lets me know that even though I know Judah is scattered to the four corners, but Israel's not. Only Judah is scattered. Only you can only find black people all over the four corners of the earth, in China, in Europe, okay? Because the Bible said that. Now, let me ask you a question. Why don't black women's hair grow past their shoulder?
That's a good question.
Well, let's see what the Bible says.
That is a great question.
Let's see. Can I ask your wife that question, sir? Excuse me, ma'am. Can I ask you a question about the black woman, please? Can you tell me why?
That's the spirit. That's Jeremiah. That's what we call him, Jeremiah, because he speaks with so much fire. You know what I mean?
Okay. Can you explain to me why doesn't black women hair grow past their shoulder, but every other nation grows down their back? White people, Chinese people, Puerto Ricans, Cubans, all these other nations hair grow down their back. But all women's hair don't grow past their shoulder. And 90%, I ain't gonna say 90, at least 75% of our women is dealing with something called alopecia.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, it is. Yes, it is. I'm telling you, you don't think 85% of our women is dealing with alopecia?
No.
So why is our women wearing weave in their hair
again?
Even
if they are, it's because...
Why are we the only women on the earth with weave?
I think it's the reason why, because of alopecia. Because they put too much strength up. They put too much...
Strength.
Tension on their hair. Chemicals.
Listen.
This is a hair all of that.
I know she is. Yeah. But what I'm telling you is this. Listen now. I have people in my family.
That's hereditary.
Okay.
It's a hereditary.
Okay, but not only in my family, in my wife's family. Okay, it didn't go past, it didn't jump through my line and go to her line.
Well,
so I'm giving you that I know for sure. I seen their hair that had alopecia in it. Okay.
I know a lot of people that do that.
Okay, so but why are we the only people suffering from that?
That was a question, because
chemicals.
No. It's a curse. It's written up in the Bible. Pull it out, Beauty. Pull it out.
What we at?
It could be a curse from the living God.
I'm talking about
Deuteronomy 28:15 says, if you do not keep the law, statutes, and commandments of the Heavenly Father, these particular curses are going to fall upon you. And I'm telling you that the children of Israel are still under the curse of today. Did everybody go through slavery? Was every nation a slave? No. We were the only ones that went into captivity that got moved from Africa over to the northern hemisphere, over to the western hemisphere. That only happened one time in history. It never happened ever, ever, ever before.
Okay, can I ask you a question?
You got the hair? The hair one?
What were you looking
at? You turn people into your religion, your Israelite, what you're talking about. What's next after that?
What's next after that? Yeah. We are supposed to rehearse the righteous acts and keep the law, statutes, and commandments that was given to us from the beginning.
And gather our brothers and sisters together.
So our work is now to bring knowledge. This is what thing that's lacking.
Do you preach Jesus Christ and why he came and what he did?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Oh yes.
Listen, how can you preach on Jesus Christ when you don't know that he was a Hebrew Israelite from the tribe of Judah?
I just said, after you get that part and then you go forward, do you teach about being born again and serving the Lord Jesus?
Absolutely.
Or not?
Oh yes.
Absolutely. That's why I was agreeing with 90% of what he was saying. No, because you're missing the Israelite part, okay? You're missing this. Give me Psalms 83. Give me Psalms 83. And this is what happened. This is what happened, okay? And this is what we're trying to overcome. We're trying to put back in the forefront of our knowledge the fact that we are Israelites. The fact that Israel is the ones that was promised to continue the oracles of the Heavenly Father and to teach the Gentiles.
The other nations,
but you know what? And now you mentioned that, and yeah, definitely, I want to hear that scripture too. But now you mentioned that, and then you notice in Hebrews chapter 1, it did speak of all the prophets speaking oracles of God, but then the last one that really kind of spoke like major prophetically and brought about the fullness of everything as a whole, like fulfilling the law, was Christ Jesus.
Okay, so let me ask you this: was there any other? This is beautiful.
Yeah.
Was there any other nation in the Bible? There was prophets?
No.
Not a one.
No.
So I'm asking you, in 2012, how can people that's not prophets, don't have the bloodline, who was not given the laws and statutes and commandments of the Heavenly Father, how can they teach?
Well, Jesus did warn about false teachers and
okay.
prophets.
Okay.
I mean, it
and many shall come in my name, yep. saying they're Christ.
Okay, yep. So you got to be
able. Many.
Yeah.
But how do you distinguish if they're telling if they're false or not?
I would always say this. I always tell people this too. That's why it's crucial to be in the Word of God and study and know. And of course, go behind the scenes and look at the original Hebrew and Greek text too, because if you don't, it's easy to be deceived by that.
But it's a lot easier for us to come to truth because we have visual knowledge of this. We can remember slavery.
Yeah.
We can remember fleeing from Jerusalem into Egypt. Because that's where we came from. We can remember those things.
Yeah.
Read and that. Then just by us having that common knowledge, we can look at the Bible and be like, this Bible.
And now we can understand better.
Yeah.
Now we can understand.
See, they didn't have this.
Can you tell me why we went to slavery, sir?
No, they didn't.
But see, I had an understanding that everybody walked with Moses across the Red Sea. But now I have an understanding that, no, it was a particular people that came with Moses. Those were my ancestors and forefathers.
Yeah.
And I was not told. I was not taught that.
No one ever taught us this.
I'm thinking that, you know.
Now, you'll notice, though,
give me that page
regarding Israel again, in the desert, the Lord was very angry with that generation. He made that crystal clear.
Oh, now, so he now, done away with him.
No, because he promised Abraham he wasn't going to do that.
You make a liar. You make a guy a liar.
Because he says, I am so grieved with these people that he said, I'm just going to let all of them die out. Except Joshua and Caleb, and I'm gonna let all the children come into the promised land. And you couldn't blame them, because when you look at how most people live,
well, that was the purpose of the 40-year wandering.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes, it was. Mm-hmm. Yes,
okay.
It was.
But yet those people's children still went into the promised land.
Yes,
was those children replaced?
Yes. Well, they weren't replaced, but because of their disobedience, they of course end up falling to Babylon. Yeah.
Okay. So what about when it says right here in Romans?
Romans. He'll never forget Israel. Never.
Romans 18.
Romans 18.
This book almost, I'll actually tell you that, hold on, we in Romans?
Yeah, Romans 18. 11. Romans. 11 and 18.
Oh, 11 and 18. Okay.
See, what you just did, I'm going to read to you what you just did out of the Bible now.
Okay.
Okay. Read that.
Boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root.
Right.
But the root thee, thou wilt say then, the branches are broken off.
The branches are broken off. The children of Israel done away with. Go ahead.
That I might be grafted in.
That the Gentiles might be grafted in. This is the boast that Paul was warning the people of.
Yes.
Don't ever say in your mind that the people of the children of Israel is done away with.
Oh, no way.
So I can never say that. No. I know you didn't. No. I know you didn't. No. If you can never say that, then you could never. You must find out who they are.
As a matter of fact,
you got to find out who they are.
And that's true, because he said it'd be easier for heaven and earth
to pass away
before God ever forgets Israel. He'll never do that.
Right. So shouldn't we know who these people are?
Yeah, I think that's crucial.
Shouldn't it be your crusade now to go and proclaim the true children of Israel?
I do tell a lot of people about Israel.
Well, but you don't believe you're an Israelite. that's what I'm saying.
I believe that there were two people when they were brought into one in Christ. That was his main goal.
Which part was you on?
Well, see,
was you a part of the Gentiles or was you a part about the?
I would have to venture to say I was a Gentile. I'm gonna tell you why though. But I'm gonna tell you why. Now this is why. This is just me personally. This is why I believe I was a Gentile.
Yeah, tell me.
It's because when you read the Acts of the Apostles, for instance. Now there was Queen Candace, which I know you all are familiar with.
You know the scripture that says to the Jew first, then to the Gentile?
Yes.
Why wouldn't you want to be a Jew, sir?
Well, he was the first Gentile convert, though.
Who?
The Ethiopian eunuch.
What does that got to do with anything?
See, that's what I'm saying. See, he was grafted in. He was one of the Gentiles.
We just read about graft.
Correct.
Go ahead.
So that's what I'm saying. So the Lord is reaching, he's going out, reaching all people, drawing all people to himself who are willing to come.
Sir, he said it's high time to wake up. It's high time to wake up. And not only that, we will be discontinued from our heritage. Okay? Here it is. You got those that saying they are Jews that are not Jews, but are the synagogue of Satan. But I bet you would never confess that that 1948, that those the Jews over there are the devil that the Bible speaks of.
Well, see, now when Jesus made that comment about them being the devil, now that particular, especially the scribes and the Pharisees of that day, they were seeking to kill him. He says, "You're not Abraham's descendants because you're seeking to kill me."
What color was Herod? Was Herod an Israelite?
Yeah, well, he was a Jewish.
No, sir. He wasn't. Sir, he was an Edomite. Do you know what an Edomite is today?
From the descendants of Edom.
Okay,
I think they were Lot's descendants.
No, not Lot. He was the twin brother of Jacob.
Jacob, yes.
Esau.
Yes.
So, where is Esau today?
In the city of Petra.
Sir. The Bible says Esau came out red all over like a hairy garment.
Right.
You have to understand that the white race is the smallest of all the people on the earth. Do you realize that?
Yeah. Newest people.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay.
But now you got to think though, what's your take on that? Because the Lord died for all people though. And he wants all people, including them.
My take is this. The Israelites got to come back to their God in order for them to help the Gentiles.
And
that's what I'm telling you.
You don't think a lot of them are now right there? Because I've seen a strong people pulling towards the Messiah now.
What people?
From Israel.
Listen, sir.
Not just.
I'm telling you that the people that's in Israel are imposters. They have lied, and the only reason they was able to go into that land is because of this image. Mm-hmm. And so this is the meat of everything we're trying to say. You are not a Gentile.
And we were in captivity when this took
place. You are not a Gentile.
Yeah.
And we have no knowledge because we was forced to worship this guy.
Yeah, and that's true, especially the early.
But sir, we just sit here and showed you the color of the people. We read 5 to 6 scriptures about the ancient Israelites and their color. Not only that, we give you a portrait here of what they looked like when they were a servant in Egypt.
Yeah.
Now you're gonna sit here and tell me that you're a Gentile.
Well, the Christians.
Wait. And you're also gonna sit here and say that those that say they are Jews in Jerusalem are these people.
Well, I mean,
can a white person turn to a black person, sir?
but see, my point is this: the main, it's still Jesus Christ, though. That's the main.
That's not the source. Point. The point is identity, sir. You can't say Jesus is the main point, and I don't understand that Jesus was a Hebrew Israelite from the tribe of Judah.
But it does say that crystal clear.
Okay, if he was black, then his people had to be black because he was actually born through a black woman named Mary.
You know what? But even if, like, let's say that's factual and that's true, it doesn't diminish truth though.
Yes, it do.
No, it does.
Truth. That's not the Bible says you should worship in spirit and truth. Because you can't worship this guy and think that you're worshiping the true God.
Because when you get saved, it's on the basis of faith.
But what about the identity and us losing identity and our nationality? What about us being the only people on the planet that don't know who they is? That should be a red flag, sir.
I agree with that. But
and you stand here calling yourself in 2012 a Gentile.
But wouldn't your true identity be in Jesus Christ, though? Jesus says when you come to him, deny yourself.
What is his true identity?
Every day
what is Jesus' true identity?
He's a son of David. a descendant of Abraham.
So we just read about how Solomon looked.
His fleshly descendant.
We just read of how Solomon looked.
Yeah.
So you can't see that this is a mental programming done against our people to keep a people asleep, to keep people slaves?
Instituted by Satan in those hidden forces.
Can't you see that we're here trying to break free from that by telling a Hebrew Israelite that he's an Israelite?
But wouldn't you really be breaking free from it if you would go through Jesus Christ, though? That he's the one that breaks the wall. He broke it at the cross.
Listen, at what time did I say I'm not going through Jesus?
No, absolutely.
I've never said that.
No, but I've said,
matter of fact, I'm in complete agreement with you.
Yes. Absolutely.
I believe that you need to go through Jesus and you need to walk in his ways, but you also need to know what he looked like.
Yeah.
You can't follow him if you think he looks like this. All the Gentiles are walking. Let me tell you, Mexicans and people down south are Catholics. They tattoo this guy on their body.
Yes, they do. Mm-hmm.
These people are the children of Israel. Shouldn't we tell the children of Israel not to partake in this false image? Especially knowing that the image that it came from was a rapist, and he died from syphilis.
Wasn't even a righteous man.
Yeah. I agree with that. I agree. Because that's a person that...
Okay, so if you agree with that, then you have to understand that the children of Israel was people of color.
No doubt.
Okay, so if there was people of color, that's a high likely chance that you are an Israelite.
That's possible.
And not only that, you don't know what your nationality is, sir.
My nationality is in Christ Jesus.
No. If I ask a Chinese man what's his nationality, he's going to tell me he's Oriental.
Yeah.
Okay? If I ask a white man, he's going to tell you he's Caucasian.
He can tell you what country he's from.
But if you ask a black man, here's another red flag. If you ask a black man who he is, he doesn't know. Matter of fact, he'll tell you one of two answers. He's black or he's African American.
Which could be true to a point. I mean, because he could be a descendant of Kush. Listen, in him.
But then who what race in Africa calls himself African?
Yeah.
What is Serge Ibaka from the Thunder?
The Congo?
Congo. He don't call himself
African. Do we call himself an African?
No.
Exactly. No, matter of fact, no country in Africa calls himself African. Matter of fact, why? Because Africa came from a man named Apricos, what's his name? Apricos.
Africanus,
who went and conquered the land and through Rome, any land that's conquered. He's a white guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So why would I call myself African, sir? Why would I take hold? Think about this for a second. Yeah. America was not always called America. No. So why in the hell would I call myself an American?
And see, the problem with this is, sir, is that we've grown up having these questions.
Which never was able to seek answers. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then we go to church to try to find ourselves and not seeking these answers.
See, what they tell us, brother, you just need to believe in Jesus and that's it. This is what you're telling me. And I'm telling you that's not enough, sir.
No.
It's not enough just to believe. No. When I pray, do I supposed to vision this image? When I pray at night, am I supposed to envision him? Or am I supposed to vision this black man with woolly hair?
Yeah, but see, what I'm saying is, it's not necessarily image. Now, the lineage is crystal clear.
But it's true.
But
this image is true.
Yes.
What? So you're supposed to worship in what?
No, but I'm just saying.
In what?
It shouldn't matter how Jesus looks. Now, his lineage is crucial.
Okay.
But his physical appearance and look is not really relevant when it
regards to... Okay, we're not saying that this is how he looked per se, but we're just saying that if somebody came in here and stole your wife's purse, you would have to give a description, sir.
Correct.
Right. And somebody's off.
And you can't just say, oh, it don't matter, just anything.
You can't say, it was a black man that ran in here, but that white dude will do. He'll do.
Yeah.
You couldn't say that, sir. So how can you say this about my? How can you say this about my Lord and Savior?
Now I can tell you, I would definitely not describe Christ as with that picture right there on the right.
But has this not been publicized to us throughout our generation?
Yes, it has.
Every movie that you've ever seen dealing with the children of Israel, have they all looked like this?
Charles and Hester.
Yeah.
Well, Moses.
Yeah, that's true. Because even the movies regarding Christ,
if they're spending millions of dollars,
and then every time they show Israelites, what they look like in the movies? Dusty, dirty.
Yeah.
These people were rich.
Yeah, they were.
Matter of fact, the richest people on the planet.
Yeah.
Through Solomon. During the time of Solomon. He raised them up to be the richest people. Why has they got them all dusty and dirty looking? They're doing that because they know who we are. We don't know who we are.
Yeah.
Right. And we don't even know that we actually...
Get 84, man. Get 84 out of this book.
Rome, 4,000 years.
Change to 84. And here's more proof of what we're seeing.
And Luke 21 confirms this.
Get Luke 21 and read that for the brother, man.
It's 21 and 20.
21 and 20, okay.
In the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem.
Listen, now this is 70 AD, what you was talking about, Titus and Vespasian.
Yeah. Go ahead. In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter.
With great slaughter. Why would one people do this to another people? Listen, if those people were both white, like they say they are, like you're saying that the Jews, if they was both white, why couldn't I just put on a Roman toga and walk out of there unscathed?
Right, because they think I'm one of them.
That's true, but you know what? Think about the early Christians who were persecuted too, who were Gentiles. Now, some of them were Jewish, but some of them were Gentiles.
Early believers, the ones that was getting thrown in the lions in an arena with the lions, those were black people, sir. And I'm finna prove it. Watch this. Yeah. Read.
In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter.
Go ahead.
During the period of the military governors of Palestine, many outrages and
Go ahead.
Were committed against the residue of the people.
All kind of abominations was committed against the people. Go ahead.
During the period from Pompey to Julius, it has been estimated that over 1 million Jews fled into Africa.
Listen, sir. Fled into where?
Africa.
Go ahead.
Fleeing from Roman persecution.
Roman persecution. Why didn't they flee to Turkey?
And the slave market was full of black Jewish slaves.
It was full of what?
Black Jewish slaves.
Yeah. So, sir, this is not something we're making up.
Now,
this is a hidden information. Yeah, go ahead and read that. This is hidden information that they've spent millions of dollars trying to keep from you and made movies and cinema done almost magic to prove to you that white guy is Jesus and the white people that's in Jerusalem today are the Jews. When this right here tells me that they were black,
they were black.
Yeah. Read that.
21 and 20?
Yeah.
No, 21 and 20. Yeah, go ahead.
And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
Yeah, Luke, hold on.
Oh, they're going to get 21 and 20.
You there?
Okay. Yep.
Okay, go ahead.
And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
Right.
Then know that the desolation thereof is nigh.
Right.
Then let them which are in Judea.
Now this is Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Flee to the mountain.
Flee to where?
Flee to the mountain.
And so the mountains, if you had a map, you can see that going into Africa, you would have to go over mountain ranges.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right through the Himalayas. Yeah. Right through the southern part. Yeah.
We came right in through here. I actually got the path right here.
See, and that's how we got to the western part of Africa. Why? Think about this for a second. Africa was already dominated. Already had people living here through the sons of Ham.
Yeah.
Okay, they was already living here. So we came in and said, okay, they're in Egypt, they're in Ethiopia, they're in Libya, they in all these lands right here. But these lands, nobody was in. Okay? So we came and over here. Now, when they came and picked us up, after the people fled, because they stayed for about 120 years, because the Most High let those that obeyed live out their life.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so he let them live out their life, but their children began to partake in these other nations' activities.
Customs. Which speaks about in...
Right?
Right.
And so the Most High allowed those that flee, he said, okay, they come over here and they still not obeying, so I'm going to let the Europeans come and enslave them.
And take them to a land.
And this is what Deuteronomy 28:68 picks up at, where it says that
and sons, they're losing their minds.